And today, the confidential agent, Liz Parker, is on the case when a factory boss gets himself into big trouble. Things are definitely hotting up in Birmingham.
You can change the world, they say, with a gun or a flower. They say the flutter of a butterfly's wing in Cradley Heath can change the weather in China. Not that you'll see a butterfly in Cradley. Not anymore. Nor here, Broad Street, Birmingham. Here, concrete rules. It's all changed now. Even in the Ace Agency. I mean, daft, innit? The boss, me, Liz Parker, spinster of the parish, and likely to stay that way. Owner and operative of the Ace Agency. Detection, debt collection, adultery observed, adultery exploited, insurance claims validated, insurance claims invalidated, missing things, missing wives, missing lovers, missing anything really. Fraud, the usual stuff. You'd never know from the outside. The Spice Emporium shut up shop, and the purveyor of dubious magazines is in the slammer for the usual reasons. Only the Ace Agency left, top floor, and who knows how long for. Inside, a rotting building seen better times. Outside, crimes just waiting to happen. The city, Brum.
Damn, damn. Hold on, I'm coming. Oh, where the hell is Mickey Antrobus? He was supposed to open up. Hold on. Yes. Ace Agency. All services, discretion assured. Can I help you?
Rosemary Martin as a confidential agent in Fire by Nick McCarty. Fire.
Oh, damn. Typical. Can't rely on Mickey Antrobus for a damn thing. You want anything done, do it yourself. Typical. Right, Liz. Kettle. Right, like gas. Kettle on. Tea. Oh, tea. Bring in tea bags. I told him I'll lay a pound to a pinch of snuff. He don't do it. Oh, blast. Letters. Oh, more wasted trees. Bin. Oh. Ace Agency. Don't hang up this time. Tell us your problem and maybe we can help. You there?
I would like to speak to Mr. Ace, if you please, miss. I know it is early.
Mr. No, he's not in right now. Can I help you? Miss Parker, operative for the agency. If you'd like to tell me, Mr.
Haji Dimitriou.
Oh, yes. Haji. Have you got another name?
My friends call me Andreas. I am Greek from Cyprus.
Right. Now, how can I help you, Mr. Haji Andreas?
I need to talk to your man there, the boss. I am owner of a factory. I need to talk to your boss.
You are?
Oh, I see. Well, I thought it was only men who did the work.
Well, apparently not. If I can help you, advise you.
Oh, well, I suppose. Very well. There have been threats to me, to my business. I have a letter today in my office. It says they will bomb me.
Hold on. Who says?
I want you to find out.
Well, it's a matter for the police, not really our territory. Not threats like that.
No, they don't listen. Maybe they don't believe me. Maybe they are very busy. Or maybe they say it's only another bloody war. Excuse me. I can pay. I pay very well. I am very worried. A bit scared, even.
Why don't you pop round? We could talk about it.
If you don't mind, not here, not there. Some other place.
Neutral ground? Right, no problem. You say where and you say when.
You know the botanical gardens?
Edgbaston. I've never been.
12:30. Outside the restaurant. There. I have grey hair, a dark suit, and my tie is silver.
I'll find you. Liz Parker's the name. See you then. Afternoon.
Now, Miss Dana, no need for the acid. I'll just get in the tea bags and some fresh milk, and I thought, as soon as I'm making the tea in future, a decent electric kettle.
Are you all right?
Oh, never felt better, Miss Boss. Tea? Anyone interested on the phone?
Not sure. Greek Cypriot says his factory's been threatened.
Really? Ignore it. Tribal warfare, more likely.
You what?
Trouble. They come here and they make trouble.
How can you say that? You don't even know him. Anyway, says he can pay. He wants some advice, so it's what we're here for, isn't it?
Oh, well, you're the boss, of course. I'll go and see him, sort him out. Advice comes very expensive, of course.
No, Mickey, you've got a job to do here, haven't you? Huh? Remember? Role reversal, you called it. You look after the office and take the odd case, and I do the legwork and the worrying.
Well, suit yourself. Where's Gloria?
Oh, well, you may ask. It is only an hour after clocking on time. You could say she was still early. So, you can sort out your stuff from the inner office, my office. Oh, there's a bloke coming with an answer phone this morning. You can see to him.
the inner office? No, that's my... I thought...
Changes, Mr. A. Changes have to be made. Oh, I'll put your certificate from the Florida Police Force Correspondence Course in fingerprinting on the desk, and the membership of the LA Homicide Bureau's drinking club is in the drawer, right? Good. Now, tell Gloria when she gets in. I'll see her later for a chat about timekeeping. Work calls, Mr. A, as my old man would say. Get to it.
Tea?
Early worms, Mr. A. Catch the business.
I'm an old man, Miss Parker. Old ideas die hard for old men. Tradition, customs, they don't vanish overnight.
You've been in England a long time, Mr. Hadji Dimitriou.
Since 51. You may call me Andreas. I was married here. My wife was from the same village. And when I come, I had 3 shillings and 6 pence. That's true. I did anything I could. Saved money, saved, work hard, build my business.
Dressmaking?
Making and making up, yes. Is hard work for me, or the women I employ for everyone. My son, Taki, joins me, and his wife. Well, his wife is born here. Not from a village. It's not the same.
And these threats?
To bomb the factory, to put me out of business, to damage my name with my suppliers or with my customers. Every day I go, and every day a new threat. A phone call, a letter, another phone call.
You have any idea who might want to threaten you?
No. Only, there's one firm, like mine. The same line of business, run by immigrants. Well, I have nothing against immigrants. I am an immigrant myself. We work hard. They work hard. But 2 firms in the same place, in the same line, is too many, maybe. His name is Mr. Khan.
Have you asked him?
No. My son says to ask. My son says to accuse him. My daughter-in-law says the same. They become angry. I know how hard Mr. Khan has to work. I have done it the same. Maybe there's pressure on him. I don't know. And I don't want to ask.
You want me?
I think a man would be safer.
No. I think maybe a woman would be safer, Mr. Andreas. I'll ask him what he knows.
Oh, well. You know why I come here? The botanical gardens?
No.
When I was a boy, we would come into Limassol on market day, my father driving goats to the market. He was not a rich man. And I would run to the seashore and along the gardens in Limassol. There was an elephant. It killed its keeper eventually. So it reminds me of home.
12 years or more, I suppose, Miss Parker. Please, come into my office where the noise may be a little less.
He was tall, all right, with smiling eyes and the slightly greying hair of a film star. A face worn a little by work and honest enough. On the table by the window, a photograph of a lady in traditional clothes and ranged alongside photographs of 4 boys.
My sons. These 2 are at university. This one is an engineer and this other one still at school. I'm very proud of them. So, some tea, maybe?
No, thank you, Mr. Khan. This isn't easy, Mr. Khan. My client is, well, frankly, not so much scared or angry even, as sad.
Andreas Hadzidimitriou and I come from the same place.
Sorry? Oh, I don't think so.
No. We come from the old Commonwealth. We came when we were more or less welcome here. Times have changed. But Mr. Andreas and I, we have seen the same things, suffered the same things. I am sorry he should even think it might be me. Or might be my children who would make such threats.
He is under pressure too from his son.
And the wife. His daughter-in-law.
Perhaps. You will understand that I have to check everything, every possibility. Have you had any threats? What's so funny?
I am a successful man. Always there are threats for successful men.
Jealousy, I suppose.
Of course. Will you please tell your client that I have made no threats? That should I hear of any, I will tell him at once. That I would be sorry if he was hurt, not least because he was kind enough to give me some help when I began. Tell him also, I respect his reluctance to ask me to my face. And any time he wants to take a cup of tea, he will be welcome here.
Behind the web of threads from the overhead bobbins, the dark faces of bejewelled women watch as I walk out into the yard of the ancient red brick factory building into a grey Brummagem afternoon.
Hello, the dress machine. Can I help you?
I wondered if Mr. Takis Hadzidimitriou was there.
He's out, as usual. This is Mrs. Hadzidimitriou, his wife. Can I help?
I wanted a word with your husband.
Can you tell me what about?
His father. Look, maybe it'd be best
if
we met.
What's the old man done now?
Well, I think if we could talk. Are you and your husband at home this evening? Or a pub, or...
Who are you?
An investigator. A private...
Detective? You're kidding. He's nuts.
If we could meet. I'm not sure what to make of what he's told me.
Oh, God, he says he's getting threats. Phone calls, he says. It's all in his imagination. Honestly, it is. Just wait till Taki hears this.
Can we meet and talk?
You're wasting your time. I don't think we're paying. This is down to him.
Right. So?
All right. We've got a flat just off the Hagley Road. Anderson Road, 35. Say, 7:30.
I'll be there.
There are some women born mean. Mean inside. She was one for sure. A voice like an ice pick. Eyes cold as winter. She only had to whisper yes or no on the phone and you'd feel the chill of Arctic wind running down your spine.
I've told you, we've both told you, he's imagining things, wasting your time.
Maybe he is, but if he is, he needs looking after. He can't go around making accusations all the time.
And who better to look after him than his son?
He can't help it. Ellie is right. But I want my old man left alone. Any questions you ask me, he's an old man.
He has delusions sometimes. Is that the word? He's obsessed. Crazy.
You're saying he's ill?
If you like.
Ellie, he is my father. Don't tell me he's crazy.
Calling in a private detective? He's crazy.
Is he around?
He's in the cafe. It's a place he goes, back of the old Paphos restaurant. It's a small room in the back, like the old days.
It's no place for a lady to go. It's a lot of silly old men pretending they're back in their villages. It's daft.
How much do we owe you?
I'll send the bill. The old Paphos, you said.
You're not going to see him, are you?
I like to finish things I begin, Mrs. Hadzidimitriou. Good night.
She didn't move when the operative left the room. Just smiled a distant smile and waved a distant goodbye from behind those dark, dark eyes. Ice.
Good night, Mr. Hadzidimitriou.
Across the room, under the strobing lights, a dark man danced. Arms stretched out, a handkerchief lying in his open palm, his feet moving suddenly fast and then a leap and a turn and the slapping of a heel and down into a crouch and then up and slow and elegant and predatory and around him the citizens of Brom threw plates and remembered package deals to Iron Appa for sun, sand and being very, very careful. Or any one of those overblown resorts of the beautiful island. I waited while a waiter checked to see if Andreas was at home to me. I don't mind admitting I was cross.
If you like to follow me, Miss
Parker. Through the curtains at the back, past the kitchen, and the smells of souvlaki, mezzies, rigani, into old Cyprus, I suppose. Old tables, some straw-bottomed chairs, battered backgammon boards, and a television high on the wall, silent. Four or five men with tin trays in front of them, holding tiny coffee cups and glasses of iced water.
Miss Parker, you will take coffee and a brandy? 5 kings, maybe?
Coffee.
Sugar?
Please.
Dimitri, energico.
It's amazing, this place.
Oh, it's a taste for us of the old place. Backgammon, cards, coffee, Greek music. Now, Miss Parker, you found something?
I found a very nice man from Pakistan who assures me it is not to do with him. He seems to like you, even. He will be glad to take a cup of tea with you.
I'm glad. I like him. I didn't want to think what I thought.
You have the letters, the threatening notes.
No. It was always on the telephone, always.
You said...
No, I was a little confused, upset. Always the fault.
I think maybe you've been wasting my time. I'm not exactly chuffed.
I assure you, Miss Parker...
I am not able to help Mr. Hadji Dimitriou. I suggest you take a rest, eh? Just have a holiday. Leave the business to the family. Good night. Dad, I remember distinctly. I asked you to get some more washing up. Oh, you never remember a damn thing, do you?
I'm sorry. I've said I'm sorry.
Go down to the shops and get... Oh, you remember to get in the chicken, don't you?
I'm sorry.
Oh, all right, all right. Now, where was I? Oh, yes, Gloria. Well, then, she did get in the afternoon. All smiles and apologies. Dad, you listening to me?
You fired her.
I couldn't.
No, couldn't. Start as you mean to go on, my wench, that's the way on it.
Here we are. Chicken and chips, just like you like them.
Oh, did you bring in a jug of ale?
There's a can in the fridge.
Oh, nuts. Cans. I'm worse than bottles. And I'm worse than a decent jug. Drop of real stuff. Oida's best. Not this pasteurised nut.
Yes, Dad, I know. In the fridge door.
So... tell us about this old bloke, this Greek bloke.
I told you, Dad. Delusions. He's a time waster, Dad. Pain in the... Mr. Antrobus is going to laugh at me for even bothering to look.
Oh, yeah. Well, we all know what a great success Mr. Antrobus was. Even let you take him over. Did you think this Greek was romancy when you first met him?
No.
So, first impression, good. Then you meet him. What then?
He was very plausible.
Well, then?
He changed his story when I asked for proof.
Please, everyone changes stories. Old men forget things, right? Might be some detail. It might be the washing up liquid. Never the important things. Yeah, pass us a sauce, would you, Liz?
I thought I'd just clear up the in-tray a bit.
Do you know what the time is, Gloria?
Yeah, 8:30. I've nearly finished the report you wanted, and I'm into typing out the spreadsheet next to the accountants, and then I...
Hold on. Couldn't you sleep?
Oh, well, I know you were cross yesterday, Miss Parker, and, well, I sort of thought maybe I should try a bit harder. I mean, the days of Mickey Antrobus are sort of... well... pretending I was a secretarial helper, dead and gone, right?
The days of buffing up your nails and calling it a day's work, yes.
I thought so. And to tell the truth, I think the days of Mr. A are gone as well. Almost.
Oh, dear.
He tells me he's going to leave Mrs. Antrobus.
I see.
It means she's twigged it and he's preparing to retreat. Dump me.
I think maybe it does, Gloria.
A woman gives the best years of her life to... men.
Oh, it's no use knocking them, Gloria. He can't help it, can he? Hormones. Has he promised you anything? I had a friend once. I remember a summer. It was a long time ago when tennis clubs had dances in the clubhouse and we wore wide frocks and cotton gloves and a kiss in the bushes was as much as anyone did without getting a reputation for being fast, you know?
No, I don't. I wish you were like that now.
He left town. I learned after he had a wife and kids in Shrewsbury. It sort of, well, like you say, Gloria, men. And talking of men, where is he?
Oh, he just nipped out. Getting the milk in, he said. And some digestive biscuits and a few...
Spare me! Apples for the teacher. Oh, it's not going to help.
I told him, it's a waste of time.
Any messages?
Oh, he took a call. Didn't say what about, though.
Right. When he comes back, send him in, Gloria. And thanks for coming in early. It helps. I'd never have guessed she could type. She spent a year, more, sitting on the edge of his desk or in other places, looking decorative. Coming to the office for some typing meant something other than secretarial work, and there she goes, like a dingbat out there. Women have hidden depths, don't they? Yes, enter.
Miss Parker. Good morning. Tea, biscuits?
Sit down, Mickey, and stop this rubbish. It gets you nowhere. Now, I'd like to know about that phone call you had.
Nothing.
Private calls in office time, Mr. Antrobus. As my old dad says, if in doubt, cards.
You're joking, of course, huh? The phone call, it was an insurance job, nothing interesting. I told them we didn't do much insurance work.
Tell me. Hmm? I'll make up my own mind what the agency does now, Mr. A.
Well, small insurance company faced with large claims want someone to check out the truth. Never easy, and not much in it. It's a fire.
A fire? Where?
Small warehouse, workshop, dressmaker's place.
Greek Cypriot? Andreas Hadjidimitriou.
Well, yeah.
Really. Get the insurance company. Huh? Tell them we will be delighted to act for them. Well, what are you waiting for? Action, Mickey, action. As your mother would have said, the early bird grabs the gobful. Shift.
Right.
Midland Union Insurance. Need to be sure, of course. You can understand their worry.
Listen, love. Our job, put the fire out, secure the premises, and then check for suspicious circs. We have a special team already standing by as soon as I tell them it's safe to go into.
Oh, yeah, right. It's not safe, then. Will they be able to reopen it?
It might, if it was totally rebuilt. It's not safe, as it stands. These old places are a fire risk. They block the exits, don't check the wiring. It's always the same. Cut the corners. Damn lucky there was no one inside, or we'd have been counting the body bags, more than likely.
Hello, Hadjidimitriou?
Mr. Hadjidimitriou, this is Liz Parker, Ace Agency. I'd like a word with your father.
We all would. He's gone missing. I suppose you've heard about the fire.
I wanted to talk to him. Ask him to call us, will you? He's got the number. Hold on. Was the building insured?
Yes, of course it was insured.
Recently?
Hold on. Tacky. My wife wants a word with you.
Right. Now you listen. It was insured. He might have been losing his grip, but it was insured by the old man and it was done recently for the market figure, OK? You're not working for him, are you?
I'm doing a job, Mrs. Hadjidimitriou.
For the bloody insurance company. If they think they can wriggle out of paying up the poor old man, they can think again. Why do you think he's gone off? His life's work down the... Just leave him alone.
Well, well. I think I might just know where to find him. He'll keep.
Across the street, the dark outline of the gutted warehouse, the soft lights of old street lamps, the cars parked like whales along pavements, broken curbs, graffitied walls, the hideous scrawls that say, I am, I exist, this is me. The signatures of the dead beat, the defeated, the stupid and the sad, that adorn all the city in mindless scrawls. Kilroy was here.
Hey, hey, missus. You're around this afternoon, right?
Yes.
Are you a copper?
Not exactly. A private investigator, more like.
Like on the telly?
Something like. You know anything about the fire at the factory?
The old bloke's a nice bloke. Your brother was talking about him. He knows something, but he's not telling anyone.
Why not?
Tell who? The police. Who, you kidding? They'll fit him up, won't they? Blame him.
Oh, come on, they're not like that.
Listen, you come from my end of the street, that's what they're like. Nothing better than to fit me brother up. But he likes the old man. We all do. He always says good morning, smiles a lot. It's worth gold, that my mum says.
Where do I find your brother?
Billy. He works in the local all-night garage, down Dale Cross, the pub. Know it?
I can find it. And?
Tell him Kevin sent you.
Thanks.
You ain't like Miami Vice, are you? Where's the stretch limo and all that?
The Menders. Good night, Kevin. Thanks.
Thanks? Hold on. It's worth a bit, that.
You what? Here, listen, love. You want pay and you should say so first. Set the price. Here. Five. Okay.
Okay.
Investigations, debts collected.
Yes, yes, Gloria. Is he there?
Not exactly, no.
What does that mean, exactly?
Well, he got a call from her indoors. She fell over a rug or something. Broke something, I hope.
Now then, Gloria. Right. Pity. What are you doing later?
Tonight? Nothing, why?
I thought we might do a bit of legwork. And add a job for Mickey. I'll do it. Interview a possible witness. See you after that, okay? Say 8:30.
You sure, Liz, this is the right thing to do? Two women on our own.
Scared?
Oh, I don't know. No, I don't think I am. I never have been scared of men and what they can do to you. It's not much more than you expect anyway, is it?
Down past the pub, the corner and the garage.
Is that where the kid is, Billy?
He said he saw a bloke trying to get into the factory. Says he saw him after he'd reported the fire before the brigade arrived. Billy says he yelled to him and the bloke sheered off, he said.
And you want to see if he comes back to the scene of the crime?
Oh, he'll come back all right. I know who it is from what Billy told me. He'll come back all right. Now, pull over down the side there. Put the lights out and wait. Nowhere is so secret as an empty street in the night. Nowhere in a city is anyone more than 8 feet from a rat. Nowhere is truly safe from the predators. And here, in the miserable, ill-lit back streets of the old industrial giant, the last faint tickings of the heart of an empire might be heard. Or is it only the clicking teeth of the rats at the woodwork and the bricks, already tearing down the city, already making it dust and ashes?
You know, Mickey?
Yes?
I was supposed to see him tonight. You know...
Oh, your business, Gloria. Nothing to do with me.
I stood him up. The story about his wife was a fib. He's hanging around the foyer of the Odeon right now, eating popcorn and trying to look as if he isn't there.
Oh, I don't know why you do it, Gloria. You don't have to.
Oh, come on, Liz. I'm on my own. I'm not as young as I was.
How old are you?
Nearly 32. What's so funny?
On the shelf, is it? Gloria, you're not an old woman. You do yourself down, don't you? Pretend you're stupid half the time. Pretend you're helpless. Are you?
Mickey likes that. He's scared of women, always has been. He was always scared of you. He's scared now.
Did he send you to talk to me?
No. I'm fond of him, Liz. He is scared. He's afraid you'll fire him. Afraid his wife will find out he had to let the business go. He's afraid I'll do a runner. Afraid... Oh, he's the right age, I suppose. Sees everything he's done turn to ashes. I mean, you didn't hang about, did you?
Well, someone had to do it, Gloria, or we'd all have been on the street. As it is, we'll get by.
No, I'm not sure he will. He's got a lot of pride, you know he has.
You are fond of him, aren't you?
Here I am. But a girl has to look out for herself, so I'm here. And not chewing popcorn in the back row of the pictures and pretending I'm not with him when the lights go up. It's not exactly easy, Liz.
I know.
You don't? What do you mean?
Well, you're not exactly treading on virgin territory, Gloria. Plenty have been your way before, kid. Oh, hold on. Look, over there by the fence. See him? At the door now. You wait here, Gloria. I'll be all right.
Are you sure?
You want to be an operative, you take a risk or two, as Mickey's mother might have said to him.
Liz, he never knew his mother. Mickey was an orphan.
Oh, bloody hell, hearts and flowers. Hold on here. Now, don't go away. I'll stay in contact with this.
Blooming cold, I know that. Next time I'll bring the cocoa.
Gloria, he's gone round the back. I'm going round after him. Hold on. Over and out.
Message timed at... Oh, blimey, it's nearly 12 o'clock.
Damn. He's gone inside. Through the back entry. It's not very well boarded up.
Be careful, Liz.
Going in now.
Nothing left but the charred remains of old tables, sewing machines sliding at crazy angles off their stands, charred bobbins, blackened walls. The streetlight shines on the pools left by the fire brigade. Hanks of cloth, sodden lumps of waste in piles on the floor. Nothing left of a man's life's work but smuts and soot and charred wood. A shell.
Glo, I'm going upstairs to the office area. It's a bit dodgy. I'll call you in a minute. Oh, blimey. Go for it, Liz.
Liz, come in, Liz.
I'm on the landing. It's okay. A bit rickety. He's in the office. I can see his torch. I'm going to give him a call, right?
I'll call the police.
Not yet. All right, come on out. There's 10 of us here. Don't try anything daft.
Miss Parker, this is very foolish of you, very dangerous. You must go outside.
Andreas, tell me what's going on here.
Will you believe me?
Tell me, I might.
I am told that the insurance company believes I burned down my own factory. I am told by my daughter-in-law that they will refuse to pay if this is the case. All I have is here, a ruin, nothing. I come to get proof that it was not set on fire by me.
Proof?
Oh, come into the office for a moment. Now, this was my office for 30 years. I built this from nothing. See, here, behind the desk is a picture frame. The photograph inside was of my archbishop, Makarios. I met him once when he came to England. It was a signed photograph, now burned.
Shame.
Behind the picture, my personal safe. Nothing good. Good enough when I began my business. In it is certain proof that I did not set fire to my life's work. Stupid, isn't it, Miss Barker, to regard a sweatshop, a dressmaking factory, or call it what you like, to regard it as one's life's work? It is all I have at.
The proof?
This tin. This. Take it. Now, I want to go away from here, and I want to sleep a little. I will talk to you tomorrow.
Will you take the tin?
No, you look after it. Now, shall we go down? Very carefully.
And the old man walked slowly out of the room in which his dreams had begun. He stopped at the door, picked up a pair of cutting-out shears and laid them neatly on what was left of the cutting table and walked into the night. And I took the tin he'd left for me and walked down to Gloria and the car.
I don't understand why you've dragged us in here. I don't get it.
It's about Dad, isn't it? Your stupid father.
Stop that, Ellie. Stop getting at him all the time.
Stop! He's a silly old man and a liability. He is. Never agrees to new ideas, new ways of working. Useless.
Is it about my father, Miss Parker?
In a way, I suppose it is, yes. We'll wait for him anyway.
You'll wait a long time, then. He didn't come home last night. He's gone missing now, just to call attention to himself like a bloody kid.
I don't think we'll wait long, Mrs. Hadjidimitriou.
I'm not wasting much more time. We've got a lot to see to. You think when a factory goes up in smoke, it's easy?
You put in the claim.
Of course. And the insurance company will try and wriggle out of it, no doubt. I mean, who can blame us? It's our lives too, isn't it? If the old man's stupid enough...
Hey, stop it.
He is a confused old man. Not responsible for his actions. You know he is, Tack, as he is honest to God he is.
We'll ask him, shall we?
Miss Parker, Mr. and, he's here.
Fine. Show him in, Gloria. And when Mr. Antrobus arrives, straight in here.
No, he's not right. He's an old man. Dad, just don't say anything you regret. Huh?
I won't. I am an old man, Ellie, true.
Dad, they'll try and twist your words. They'll wriggle out of the climb. They'll say it was done on purpose.
What would you say to that?
Dad, come on, Panayama, what are you saying?
He doesn't know what he's saying. She's working for the insurance company, Dad, trying to stop us getting what we're owed.
I think she talks too much, your wife, Takis. Tell her.
It was the others. They did it. They were always jealous, Dad. They burned the place.
I have known Mr. Khan since he came to England. He did not do it.
The police will be involved, Dad, they say.
Well, some people say you did it. To collect the insurance money.
No, he didn't do it. I know he didn't burn it down.
Panayamu, tell her the truth, Dad. We can't get the money to get off our backs like we can at home. It's not like we got a cousin or a brother in the police or the insurance company or...
Come in.
Morning, Miss Parker. In time, am I?
What does he want?
Nothing. I'll tell you what, Miss Parker, you were right about that lad at the filling station.
What lad? What filling station?
Billy, brother of Kevin. Yes, very helpful indeed. He runs the all-night garage near the factory, most observant. I wrote it all down for you, Miss Parker. You'll find it all there, I think.
I want to see that.
In good time. Your father-in-law didn't pay the premiums, did he?
It was insured.
Yes, I know. For more than it was worth, considering its condition. Who insured it?
I am a partner. My wife runs the office. It's nothing without us.
No. It is nothing, my son. I will tell you something so you know it wasn't me that burned the place down.
I'm not going to stop here and listen to more rubbish from the old fool.
You will stay, Ellie. Sit down and for once close your mouth. Takis, after your mother died, all I wanted was to go back home. Every year I put this... or that on one side cashier and there, put it away.
How much? 300? 400?
10,000 pounds. I didn't tell you, Tacky, for she would have taken it and wasted it. It was for my old age, for me to go home, to retire, to be happy in the sunshine, in the coffee shop.
So... where is this amazing £10,000? Which bank?
No bank. Show her, Andreas.
Here. wanting. Burned, as you can see on the outside. It was in the safe behind the picture of Makarios in my office. And in it was £10,000 in notes. Now, what do we have?
Look, can you open the tin, Mr. Antrobus? I think he finds it hard.
No. I shall do it.
You see what's inside it, Ellie? Oh. Tip it up, Mr. Hadji Dimitriou. Empty it.
No! Ashes! Just ashes!
He didn't fire the building, you see, Ellie. He had everything to lose. £10,000 in an old safe. Ashes. You and Tacky, on the other hand.
You stupid bloody old fool! It wasn't me! Nothing to do with me!
Well, it's... Funny you should say that, Mrs. You see, the lad at the filling station distinctly remembers selling a gallon can to a bloke who had a lady in the car. Long black hair, he said. Slightly foreign looking, he said. Even heard the name she called the man. Takis, she said. Loud and clear, Takis, bring some cigarettes. Billy is a very good witness.
Nothing to say, Mrs. Hadji Dimitriou?
I am sorry for her.
I'm sorrier for your son, to tell the truth.
His mother warned him when he came home first with her. She warned him, but he would never listen. Now he has his own bed to lie in.
And you?
Oh, the trick was to return a rich man.
Yes?
You are a rich man when you know you will never be one. My village is on one side of a hill, looking down over silver olive trees and vines and so on down to the sea. It's... You must come sometime.
A bit too quiet, maybe.
For an old man, no.
Will you go?
I want to sit in the courtyard of my family house and to drink coffee with old friends. I will go. I will have sunshine and white walls of my own house. The children shouting in the village. The trick is to say, enough is enough. Takis and his wife can make what they will of what is left. They don't know yet. Mr. Khan always admired my house. This morning, I sold it to him. For cash, of course.
Change the world? Fat chance. You get out there in them streets and you look at it and wonder where to begin. Dirt and poverty, cardboard cities and greed, glitz and diamonds, anger, violence, cruelty, dog eat dog and child eat father. What's the difference? And while they're there stalking the streets, there's a place for us and all. The Ace Agency, Broad Street, Brum, me and Antrobus, and even Gloria. Take on the world, us, and never be surprised. That's the trick. And save. For someone, some victim, some frightened man or woman, some eager client. The hint of a dream, even. A house, a seat under the vines, summer flowers, swans by the cut, of a warm day and the drowsy humming of a bee in the long grass. Youth, even. We'll be there, all right. Yeah.
In Fire by Nick McCarty, Liz Parker was Rosemary Martin. Antrobus, Terry Malloy. Gloria, Claire Falconbridge. Dad, Roger Hume. Andreas, Ian Lindsay. Takis, Kim Durham. Ellie, Patricia Gallimore. Mr. Khan, Renu Setna, and Kevin, Philip Malloy. Other parts were played by members of the cast. Fire was directed in our Pebble Mill studios by Philip Martin.
Our detective series, Stone, created by Danny Brocklehurst and starring Hugo Speer as DCI Stone. In today's episode, Demons by Martin Jameson. A young man is viciously stabbed in front of his twin brother, and DCI Stone investigates whether it could be a case of mistaken identity.
All right, that's fine. I'll pick your uncle, brothers.
Oh, to meet you, to meet you, to meet you, to meet you, to meet you.
Ignore him. He's been like this all night.
Chuckle, brother!
Jamal, don't be a crap.
Give him a break, Emian. I mean, you go out dressed the same. What do you expect?
To mess with your head, Nassim.
Usual.
Actually, we were thinking about a couple of them posh steaks.
So that's two kind of a chilli sauce.
Lemon juice. He always forgets the lemon juice.
Cos he waters it down.
Oi! Whoa, man, four missed calls.
Shazia?
Yeah.
She's got you on a string, bro.
Hey, Naz, I just spent the whole evening trying to pull him a bird, and now he's giving me relationship advice. I don't need your help to pull women, OK? I don't need his help.
Well, it sounds a bit pervy to me.
Can't get a signal. Watch him. I don't want any of the cold scraps. Don't let him burn the pizza.
Yeah, I won't.
Hey, babes, it's me. I've got four missed calls. There's no need, yeah? I'm on my way. And I don't want you throwing a moody when I get there. Right, mate, watch yourself. I'm on the phone.
So what happens? Does he pretend to be you and then you swap at last minute?
He's only mucking about.
You're going to be right now when they discover they pulled a Muppet like you, Jamal.
Hey, what's he doing?
Ignore him.
No, mate, that's blood. Oh, my God.
Go get the police.
Hey, mate! What's going on, bro?
Me. He bloody stabbed me.
Shit.
This is a bit scary.
No, 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 no! Emmy!
And then what?
He just looked at me. I've never seen anyone that scared. Then he passed out. I was shouting at him. Wake up! Wake up, you stupid bastard! It's me who's the lazy ass!
Do you want to take a break?
I don't know. No. Let's get on with it.
Did he say anything else about the attacker?
No, just that he's bloody stabbed me.
He?
Yeah.
Like you knew him?
What? No.
How'd you know? Did you ask him?
Of course I didn't.
Why, of course.
It wasn't exactly top of my list. What is this?
No one's criticising you, Jamal.
We need to know if Emir knew his attacker.
Why would he? He didn't, I've told you.
And you didn't see anyone running away?
No.
Maybe someone was following you. You didn't notice anything at the time? Someone hanging around, behaving strangely?
No.
You said Emir went out to make a call?
His girlfriend, Shazia.
You see him talking to anyone? An argument? Anything like that?
I didn't see nothing. Not till Emir slammed against the window. I thought he were mucking around. Then I saw the blood and... Sorry.
Boss?
Can you think of anyone who'd want to hurt your brother?
No. Everyone loves Emir.
Everyone?
He was one of those people.
You're twins. Identical twins.
What about it?
You must have been very close.
If you're going to start with a twins crap, like there's something magic about it, you know, all that mind-reading stuff, it's not like that. It's more. It's real. You've been in your mum's womb together. You can't be any closer to no one. You're part of each other. You know what? The only time I were ever properly on my own was that 9 minutes after I were born. He used to say he'd hung around inside mum as long as he... could, just to get a bit of peace and quiet.
Hey.
I'm all right. I'm all right.
Is there any chance it was mistaken identity?
What?
You were wearing the same clothes.
We'd been down the locks. The clothes thing, it's like a double babe magnet.
I thought Amir had a girlfriend.
Yeah, well, I don't. He had this idea he was going to pull me a woman.
Is there anyone who'd want to hurt you?
What are you saying?
I think you know what I'm saying.
You're trying to make out like it's my fault.
We're trying to find the person who did this.
I've told you everything I know.
If someone's after you, it won't be long before they find out they got the wrong guy.
I wish it had been me, all right, but it wasn't, OK? And there's nothing I can do about that.
Oh, Jamal. Come here. Come here.
Mum's stone.
What happened? Who was it who did this?
Look, can we get out of here?
Jamal could do some rest.
We went to see him. He looked like he was sleeping. I, told him you loved him.
Not here, Mum Taz.
Mr. and Mrs. Khan, I'm DCI John Stone. I'll be leading the investigation. This is Detective Sergeant Sue Kelly.
I'm so sorry for your loss.
Find out who did this. That's all that matters.
We intend to.
It'll be racists. One of those crazies off the internet.
Obviously, that's a line of inquiry.
No one who knew Amir would ever want to hurt a hair on his head.
Can we go home now, please?
If I can ask you not to touch anything in his bedroom.
Did you not hear what I said?
These are very early days.
You should be online, checking the websites. Someone will be bragging about it.
Saeed was beaten up by thugs after the bombings in London.
I'm sorry.
Don't be sorry, just find them.
What do you think, Jamal? You and your brother ever had hassle around there?
Yeah, once or twice. It's possible. Definitely.
Boss.
What's with the face?
Jamal just lost his twin brother.
What, you think he was hard on him?
Jumping in with the mistaken identity thing, kind of insensitive.
First 24 hours, Sue. You know the way it works.
There are ways and ways.
Someone gets hit. First question. Are they the intended target? Twin or no twin?
We don't have to make him feel like he's some kind of suspect.
You gotta shake the pot to see what falls out, Sue. You saw his reaction.
He was upset.
And when the parents came, all they wanted to know was who did this. Jamal didn't seem interested. It was like he already knew. Tanner.
Two ticks.
Mature DI seeks arresting female for forensic examination. Nice one.
That's pathetic, Sue.
Touched a nerve.
Ignore her, boss. She's winding you up.
Shame. Had my pulse racing. Thrill me with something else, Mike.
Well, the bad news is that the CCTV outside the kebab shop was knackered. We've got one witness. She didn't see the attack, but maybe she saw someone in a grey or green cagoule walking off in a hurry. But the hood was up, so we don't have a racial. She did tell me about her macular degeneration, which was fun.
Did forensics get back to you soon?
It was dry, so no footprints. If the attacker was wearing a cagoule, we're not going to get any fibres.
Weapon?
Knife was sharp, straight, clean. Probably a 6-inch kitchen knife, the sort everybody has.
What about the good news?
What good news?
Well, Mike started with bad news. Even I know that means there's good news somewhere in the mix.
We've got the girlfriend's voicemail. It'll take us a week to get a proper audio analysis, so I've loaded it onto this sound editing software I've got.
That you just happened to have?
There's nothing unusual about having sound editing software.
As long as we know how indispensable you are.
You should answer his ad, Sue. Sparks could fly.
Here we go.
Hey, babe, it's me. I've got four missed calls. There's no need, yeah? I'm on my way. I don't want you trying to move me when I get there. Hi, babe, watch yourself. I'm on the phone. What are you doing?
There, he said something.
Shh. What? Sorry, babe. Some idiot giving me afro. I said, get out of my face. He told me. Stop me. Oh, bloody hell. Come on!
Go back.
I can boost it. I saw all the lights away. Sorry, it was something I was...
Long, lonely nights, Mike.
Now I know why we have experts for this sort of thing.
I've got it.
A racist attack.
It's too organised, too targeted. They don't normally go in for the one-on-one hit. More likely to be 4-1 at a bus stop. You have to die, he told me. That's personal.
Keep an open mind, though, about the racists.
Is that your idea of irony?
Mr. Stone, we've come to take that look at Emir's room.
If that's okay.
Who is it? Police.
Mrs. Khan. Oh.
Were you expecting someone?
I told you we should have rung her.
From what you're saying, Jamal's only been gone a few hours.
He's left his keys. His house keys.
Jamal's cousins, they're out looking, putting the word round.
We've rung everywhere. Nobody's seen him anywhere.
He's 23. It's a bit soon to be listing him as a missing person.
Show him the note.
This was on the table, under the keys. I'm sorry, you're better off without me, Jamal.
Can I see?
Sounds like a suicide.
We don't know that. How was he last night?
His brother just died in his arms. He still had blood on his clothes.
He went straight to his room. He wouldn't eat any food.
I tried to talk to him, but he slammed the door in my face.
I kept thinking, perhaps Amir will come home soon and talk some sense into him.
Sit down, Mrs. Carr.
I thought about calling the doctor.
But when I went in this morning...
We have to find him before he does something.
I can't lose them both.
Okay. We need his mobile number, a list of his friends, bank details. Does he have a computer?
It's all in his room.
The boys' rooms are next to each other.
No, Mumtaz, stay where you are.
I can't sit here doing nothing.
It's all right, Mrs. Khan, we'll find it.
If you could sort out a photograph, something recent.
Yeah, I'll have a look.
This way.
In here?
What was that look?
What look?
When we told you about Jamal, you looked at the young lady here.
Did I?
You think he knows something about Amir's killer?
We don't think anything yet, do we, boss?
You tell us, Mr. Khan. Is it a possibility? Is Jamal hiding something?
Why are you blaming him?
We're not blaming anybody.
Your son's run away. I have to ask what he's running away from.
I'm terrified that my one remaining child is going to be found at the bottom of a river, dead with a broken heart, and you're treating him like a suspect.
Jamal isn't a suspect.
He's an assistant manager in a mobile phone shop. He's not some thieving lout in a street gang.
But if he knows something, anything...
An Asian boy has been murdered in cold blood. His killer is still on the loose. Why can't you see this for what it is?
With respect, Mr. Khan, we don't know what it is. Not yet.
Then promise me something. Don't tell my wife about your suspicions. If you do, it will kill her.
Sue, you'll want to hear this.
Boss?
I've had Davis go through Amir's laptop.
And I've just come back from Phonorama.
Mike's got the juice on Jamal from his boss.
I sense a heartwarming I told you so moment coming on.
Amir was clean. IT manager, 3 promotions in 2 years. He's financially solvent and all the money is accountable. Incomings, outgoings, everything matches. The worst Davis could dig up on him is a bit of internet porn on his browsing history. Nothing dodgy.
Oh, that's all right, then.
What about the girlfriend?
Well, I doubt she's seen it, but I haven't asked her.
Boys.
Seriously, boss, what do we know about her?
Shazia Malik, last year of college. Ambitious, drop-dead gorgeous. They'd been going out for about 6 months. Judging from their text, she's a bit possessive, maybe, but there's nothing on his computer or his phone that suggests he was playing away.
You see that thing on the news last night?
The kids from the Mandela Centre.
Emmy was there 3 nights a week, voluntary. Those lads worshipped him.
The only people who are going to want to take this guy out are the Mother Teresa Appreciation Society.
Or some racist thug who could strike again at any time.
You have to die, he told me. It's a hit. Some kid earning his stripes for the big boys. Not the first time we've seen it.
Only not with someone this clean.
Or an assistant manager in a phone shop, to be fair.
Except Jamal isn't. He's a shop floor grunt and not a very good one at that. Manager says he's unreliable, lazy, this close to getting the push.
Money troubles?
Take a look. Jamal gets in a mess, and then he makes cash deposits. It's happened about 6 times. Never quite gets him in the black, but it's more than he's earning at Phonorama.
Amir's subbing him?
We're talking 200-300 quid a pop. This last one, 500. You'd have seen it if it was coming from Amir. And from what you said about Mr. Khan, the last thing Jamal's going to do is go running to Daddy for a bailout.
So Jamal's into something dodgy. He's ripped someone off, and they've come for payback. Only they get the wrong guy.
Makes sense.
And now he's done a runner because he knows they'll come after him as soon as they realise they've got the wrong guy. Let's hope we can find him before they do. Sue, are we any closer to getting a trace?
He's not using his cards, not using his phone. And while we're at it, I've been through his call history and it's strictly friends and family. There's nothing suspicious there.
He works in a phone shop. He could have any number of pay-as-you-go handsets.
He's been there 5 months. Shouldn't take too long to get a short list of SIM cards that he might have sold to himself.
Or any kit that's gone missing. I'm on it.
Boss! Aren't we running away with ourselves?
We don't have everything, but it smells right to me.
The two things aren't necessarily connected.
If it looks like a duck.
Just because Jamal's in a mess, it doesn't mean someone wants to murder him.
But they did. Only they got the wrong guy.
What we've got is a completely innocent young man getting knifed outside a kebab shop. If he didn't have an identical twin, we'd be treating this like a random murder. Probably with racist overtones, like Mr. Khan is saying. If it looks like a duck.
That's not the way we're going on this.
You're going.
Last I heard, it was still my investigation.
We should issue a public alert.
It's a gang hit, Sue.
Tanner's right. We don't want to start a panic or a riot. Let's keep this small.
Greater Manchester Police have issued an appeal to find the twin brother of murdered IT manager Amir Khan. Mr. Khan's brother, Jamal Khan, disappeared on Wednesday morning, the day after his brother's murder.
Cat, I'll be up in a minute. Just have to catch this.
But police are extremely concerned to know of Mr. Khan's whereabouts, and anyone with information should call the hotline number on the bottom of your screen. In a further development, community leaders are expressing unhappiness with the police investigation.
What the...
Our reporter spoke to Mohammed Begum from the East Lane Community Centre.
It's like the police never learn. We have it on good authority that the murder of Amir Khan was a racist attack. We want to see a stronger police presence on our streets. We want to know that the police take this seriously. Because right now it seems like there's a killer on the loose and no one's that bothered.
On good authority.
A police spokesman declined to comment on Mr. Begum's accusations, saying that a variety of leads were being pursued.
Great. Just great. You wanted to see me?
The Khan murder. Just making sure you're on track with that.
You've seen the file? Got any better suggestions?
Well, the thing is, John, once someone like Begum gets hold of it, we can't pretend it hasn't happened. We have to be seen to be taking community issues seriously.
I don't have the resources to staff two investigations.
We'll make a few inquiries. It's about sending out the right messages.
Funny. I thought it was about finding the person who murdered Amir Khan.
The body's been released in the morning, and the family are going for burial as quickly as possible. Islamic tradition. I'm allocating two tactical units in case anything kicks off. Feelings are running high.
Dave Morgan will do a good job.
I want you there, John. Make your presence known.
Sir...
One more thing.
Gov?
Begum said that he had it on good authority that it was a racist attack. Well, I was wondering whether you had any idea whose authority that might be.
Not a clue.
Yeah, just make sure you have your team on board.
All right.
The vans are up on Warwick Drive. There's a couple of uniform around by the mosque, but it's looking quiet, so hopefully the guys can stay in the van.
Happy now.
All what? Units, Garvey Avenue, reports of youths assaulting IC1 male at bus stop on Junction.
Come on, Sue. I know what's going on.
Boss?
If you've got a problem with how I'm running this investigation, then say so.
So that you can ignore it?
I don't expect our disagreements to be played out on the local news.
Why do you assume that had anything to do with me?
Because you've been lurking around the office like a bad hangover for weeks now.
You know how to make a girl feel special.
Needling Mike all the time.
You want me to be honest?
I want you to be part of the team.
How's that going to work if I can't trust him? If I don't know whether I can trust you?
We're a team, Sue. I've risked my backside making sure we stay that way.
Maybe that's the problem.
How'd you work that one out?
Ever since that business with the Kitowski murder, it's like you've got Mike in your pocket.
He's a good detective. There was no way I was letting him go down. You know I'd do the same for you.
Maybe there's a reason you haven't had to do that.
Everybody needs a second chance.
You've got him on a lead and I don't get a look in. I might as well be answering the phones.
DCI Stone. When? Okay, we'll be right there.
What?
Someone's torched the Khan's house.
Safe's coming. Mind your step there, might still be a bit warm.
Arson?
Well, a chap over the road saw three guys in a black BMW 5 Series lobbing a Molotov cocktail through the front window.
Gaffer's gonna have my balls.
It's off the scale. No one saw this coming.
Especially you.
That's out of order.
You still think Amir Khan was the target?
Hoodie with a knife, three heavies and a BMW. Something doesn't fit.
Oh, my God! Is this ever going to end?
No. It looks worse than it is.
No. What did you say?
It's the downstairs front. The rest of the house is not so bad. Livable.
What kind of sick bastard burns someone's house when they're at their child's funeral?
Someone who wants to send a message.
What, that they hate us? I think I already understood that.
They want your son. They want Jamal, and they're not going to stop until they get him.
Family home while they were
out at the funeral for their son, Amir, stabbed to death outside alongside kebab shop last week.
That's what you want. That's what you want. That's what you want.
Excuse me, sir.
You're not permitted to park on this part of the quay.
If you could lower your window, sir, can you show me what it is you're drinking?
I'd like you to turn off the engine and step out of the car. I have reason to believe you are drunk in charge of a motor vehicle.
Switch off the engine, please, sir.
Bloody hell!
Been trying to call you.
Alice dropped my phone charger in the toilet. Believe it or not, that's true.
We found Jamal Khan.
Dead or alive?
Damp.
Talk to me, Jamal. Tell me who murdered your brother. Oh, look, you're gonna have to start talking sooner or later. Unless you want another shot at driving into Salford Quays. But I wouldn't recommend it.
You think this is funny?
Well, you've tried running away, but they're not going to let you do that, are they? They'll go after everyone you know and love, and they won't stop until they've got your head on a plate.
Why didn't you let me drown?
Well, grow up, Jamal. You're never going to kill yourself. You're too much of a coward.
You bastard!
Not like your brother.
I'm not telling you nothing.
The golden boy. Great job, hot girlfriend. Everybody loves him. For all we know, you arranged the whole thing.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I killed him. I killed him here. If it wasn't for me, he'd still be alive. Happy. Is that what you want to hear?
Come on, snap out of it before someone else gets hurt. Because that's what's going to happen if you don't stop playing silly buggers.
I've been doing stuff for Kieran Connor. Heard of him?
We know Kieran.
Bit out of your league. What were you doing for him exactly?
Deliveries. I never saw what was in them, though. The packages.
Of course you didn't. But for future reference, I think you'll find it was addiction and misery.
I just wanted enough cash to make it look like everything was all right. I mean, I'm not a criminal. I couldn't stick it. The way people looked at me when I was out with Amir. Like they knew.
Knew what?
That I weren't as good as him.
So how does Kieran Connor end up wanting to kill you?
His girlfriend, Rhiannon Clark. Oh. Me and her, we, you know.
What, you had sex with her?
There was this time Kieran were out in Amsterdam. I went to his flat and she were there on her own. She come on to me.
So your brother dies because you have a quickie with Kieran Connor's girlfriend?
It wasn't a quickie. We were... I'm in love with her. Don't laugh at me!
We're not laughing.
It felt good. Having this secret thing. No one knew. Not even a me. So, when they give me that look, I'm thinking, suckers. You don't know the half of it.
How did Kieran find out?
I'm supposed to be meeting Rhiannon one time, and she doesn't show. She's not answering a text or nothing. I mean, I've given her this secret phone from the shop, because I know Kieran checks her text.
When was this?
A couple of weeks ago. Next time I get to the flat, Rhiannon, her face is all smashed up. Looks like she's been in a cage fight. Rhee gets me on her own for about 10 seconds. She swears to me she hasn't told him, but he suspects, and whatever I do, I've got to go on as normal, or he'll guess for sure. I'm thinking, I want to kill him. I'm thinking, how can I hurt him? How can I get him back? So I go and find Joey Lemington. You know, the Lemingtons. And I tell them stuff. stuff.
Joey, give me 500 quid. I weren't expecting that.
What sort of stuff?
Like, I know where there's two weed rooms and some lockups where Kieran keeps a load of knockoff.
Is that it?
What?
Go on.
So, I'm waiting for something to happen, but it doesn't, and that sort of freaks me out. But I think maybe Joey didn't believe me, so I sort of forget about it.
You forget about selling Kieran Connor out to Joey Lemington? You really aren't very clever, are you?
I know, all right. Don't you think I know?
Go on, Jamal.
Anyway, then I get this text from one of Kieran's guys saying I've got to go and meet Kieran down that car park on Tether Street, and I freak this time for real. I mean, what's he want to meet me there for?
I've got a horrible feeling I know where this is going.
Yeah, well, I bottled it, didn't I? I'm thinking I'll make a run for it, but it's like I'm sort of paralysed. So I say to myself, I'll just carry on as normal, and if anyone asks me, I'll say, like, I forgot or I didn't get the text. I mean, how are they going to know?
So you went out with your brother instead?
I just stopped thinking about it. And we're down the locks having a laugh, and then we're in the kebab shop, and then he goes out to ring Shazia and...
What a waste.
What am I going to say to my mum?
Talk about a stupid way to die.
So what now?
We pull in Kieran Connor.
Help him with our inquiries or going in heavy.
Anything on the Beamer? If we can get him on the arse and... Sue, you don't look happy.
Boss, that's a smiley face.
Do you want to hear it?
Always.
I don't doubt a single word of what Jamal told us. No one's going to make up a story that pathetic. But we've got nothing. No weapon, no witnesses. Nothing putting Kieran Connor at the scene. We couldn't even get conspiracy.
It's a shakedown. He needs to know we're watching him. We lean on him. We lean on his crew. Turn them upside down and see what falls out.
Sounds good to me.
Jamal might be an idiot, but he didn't kill his brother. We owe it to the Khans. Connor's going down for this.
You're the boss.
I am. Right, we're fit. Let's do it. Kieran Connor.
Oh, you're joking.
I'm arresting you on suspicion of conspiracy to murder Jamal Khan.
Oh, this is a bloody joke.
And the manslaughter of Emir Khan.
You don't need to say anything,
but it may harm your defence if you do not mention when questioned, something which you later rely on in court. Anything you do say may be...
Get your hands up,
Ben! Terry, call Sheldon and get him down in it. This is bollocks.
Get him out of here, come on!
Mind your head.
Interview with Kieran Connor, 6th March 2012. Present are DCI John Stone.
DI Mike Tanner.
Mr. Connor's solicitor, Philip Sheldon.
Right, Kieran. Let's see if we can fill this tape with something other than 4 hours of no comment.
Well, what do you know? It's your lucky day.
Should have bought one of those lottery tickets, boss.
The only thing I know about that little rump can is that it turns out he's knocking off my girlfriend. Who's a tart anyway? And you only know that because some goon goes and totals his twin brother who I've never even met. First thing I hear about it is Rihanna going mental and screaming at me that I'm going round Manchester murdering Asian boys.
Why would you think that?
I don't know. Ask her.
I've heard you're the jealous type.
I didn't know he would have an affair. Not till after the brother got knifed. And if he was half as thick as the other one, then it's no wonder someone wanted to do him.
You must feel pretty stupid getting the wrong guy.
You're the one making a prat of himself.
You've been made to look a fool. You had to smoke him out. Let Jamal know that running wasn't an answer.
Jamal Khan took something that one is. There's a price for that. But I didn't kill his brother.
So you admit torching the Khan's house?
No comment.
Where were you on the Tuesday night?
God's sake.
Attempted murder?
Only if the person that did it hadn't been near the telly and didn't know the whole family were out at the brother's funeral.
Can I take that as an admission?
This whole interview is based on hearsay. If you have nothing of substance to put to my client, then I politely suggest we reconvene when you do.
Jamal Khan received a text summoning him to the Tether Street car park.
Probably. He didn't show.
So you went after him?
It wasn't anything to do with Khan. I just needed a few of the lads.
What was the purpose of that meeting?
No comment.
No comment.
When I say no comment, I mean it's none of your bloody business. Not no comment because we're going to stick a knife in him. Just so we're clear.
Nothing to do with Joey Lemington?
What?
Someone passing information about your operation to Joey Lemington.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Let's go back to the Tuesday night.
Whoa, no, rewind. Are you telling me Khan was snitching to the Lemingtons?
Boss?
D.S. Kelly has entered the room.
Thought you might like to see this.
Thanks.
Bingo.
I'm showing the suspect a photograph of a black BMW 5 Series, believed stolen, matching a vehicle seen outside 47 Moseley Terrace last Friday, immediately prior to an arson attack on Jamal Khan's family home.
Nice motor.
This photograph was taken 2 hours ago in one of your lockups. Anything you'd like to say about that?
Right, you've got to get me out of here, Phil.
Do you need to be some work, Kieran?
No comment. Stone.
Miss McCaffrey.
Hold on.
What the hell's going on with Kieran Connor?
Holding him overnight. I think we can get him on the arson.
Well, you should have cleared it with me.
How? You've been at that policing austerity conference.
You should have waited until I got back.
I have no idea what's going on here.
Well, get your ass down to the station and I'll show you.
It's 10 to 3.
Then you might want to listen to the radio on the way. They're not playing Christa Berg, I can tell you that much.
Parts of central Manchester are on lockdown tonight in what appears to be a turf war between rival gangs in the south of the city. Masked raiders have mounted simultaneous attacks on several popular nightclubs.
Brilliant.
Police were caught unawares as they were forced to cordon off roads around Piccadilly Gardens. There have been 3 reported shootings and one man is in a coma after being struck with a baseball bat.
With respect, I don't see what this has to do with me. If the Lemingtons were waiting to make a move on Connor, it could have happened any time.
But he did it today because some clown in this station decided to stick Kieran Connor in a cell for the night.
On suspicion of arson and quite probably murder.
You are nowhere near having the evidence to move on Kieran Connor.
What happened to sending out a message to the community? What?
I see you have had someone in the Connor camp for 6 months. And the whole operation's gone south.
John, wake up.
Is that for me?
Coffee and a chocolate. It was that or cheesy puffs.
You spoil me. What time is it?
8:30. I heard what happened.
McCaffrey had me helping out in custody till 6.
Shoveling the brown stuff.
Metaphorically.
Explains one thing, though.
What?
Jamal Khan thought Connor was after him because he snitched to Lemington. But I reckon Connor was telling the truth when he said he didn't know about that. Lemington never moved on the info Jamal gave him because he didn't want to draw attention to himself.
Yeah, I think he worked that one out around about the 10th meathead last night.
Boss, we've had a call from the hospital. A chap called Dale D'Souza. Remember the other day, assault at the bus stop on Garvey Avenue?
No. Not really.
The guy's been in intensive care. Anyway, he's come round, been talking to Uniform, but he's insisting that he won't press charges.
You and Mike sort it. I'm going home. And play nice.
No, John, you're going to want to take this.
Are you absolutely sure you want to do this, Dale?
Yes. Yeah, yes, I told you.
Hello, Dale. My name's John Stone. I'm a DCI, and I've come to talk to you about the attack.
DS Sue Kelly. Hi.
I can't pretend I'm happy about this. If I feel that Dale's becoming unduly distressed, I will pull the plug, OK?
Sure.
Go away!
He's not talking to you.
I'm aware of that.
Leave me alone!
No, let's stop. You're not well enough to do this, Dale.
No. I want to. I have to. Please. Oh, it's fine. I want to talk to the detective. It's up to me. Don't tell me what I can't do. It's bad enough with him.
It's all right, Dale. You take your time. We know who attacked you. The officer says you don't want to press charges.
No.
We have all the witnesses, so there is a possibility we can bring charges without you having to go to court. Would that help you, Dale?
You can't blame them.
We're talking grievous bodily harm. It's a very serious offence.
He had to punish me.
Punish you?
I should have said no. I should have said no, 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 no. I should have told him to...
Who?
He told me the boy was evil. He was... The boy was poison. He wouldn't shut up. He made me.
Who?
There were two of them. That's how you can tell. In the kebab shop. One of them was all right. It was the older one. I had to stop him. To kill it. I had to.
Are you saying that you stabbed Amir Khan?
Amir Khan?
How long had you known the Khan brothers?
What?
Did you know Amir Khan?
Detective.
Amir? That means Prince, doesn't it? I read that. We've had his name.
Recognize him?
No.
You're absolutely sure about that?
Never seen him before.
The hospital had Mr. D'Souza's cagoule bagged up with his things. They assumed the blood was his, but forensics confirmed that it came from Amir. Some of it.
He'd been sleeping in the empty flats on Braemar Terrace. One of the old tenants left a set of kitchen knives in a cupboard. The one that Dale used was on the floor. He hadn't washed it, hadn't even tried to hide it.
You said he was a paranoid schizophrenic?
He'd been in a unit up Gateshead way. It was closed a few months back. Budget cuts. Dale was moved to a clinic in Sunderland, but during the transfer, he went AWOL.
He just wandered off?
Police were informed.
There's a whole set of procedures.
But then he's halfway across the country. He's got no phone. He's sleeping rough.
He's off his medication.
He, fell off the radar. The CPS will be bringing a prosecution, but... It's only fair to warn you that it's possible a judge may rule that Mr. D'Souza isn't fit to stand trial.
So where is he now?
Secure unit.
Secure?
Trial or no trial, he's unlikely to be released anytime soon.
Is that the best you can do?
You could contact the health authority. There might be a case for negligence.
I don't want to prosecute some faceless bureaucrat. How is that going to make sense of anything?
Well, at least...
At least what?
You weren't responsible for what happened, Jamal. And, I'm sorry we put you through that.
Like it makes a difference now.
It makes a huge difference.
I don't even feel like their son anymore.
Oh, Jamal, don't talk like
no,
that.
No, get off me. Don't touch me. I know what you think. It doesn't matter now. But you blamed me. No, no, worse than that. You thought the wrong son died.
No,
Jamal. Don't tell me you didn't, because I've seen it in your eyes. Every day.
There's no way back from that. No way back.
Coming to the pub? I think Mike's been stood up by one of his internet babes, so it could be a long one.
Kat's expecting me.
Meaning?
Kat's expecting me.
John?
I'm supposed to be the guy who rides into town and finds out who the bad guys are. All I've done is leave the Khan family with a great big gaping wound. Not sure I can wash that away with a pint of lager.
Shit happens.
That's not good enough, Sue.
You didn't kill Amir Khan.
You know it's not that simple.
There's no way any of us could have known about Dale D'Souza. We had nothing to go on, none of us.
What you said about me and Mike. You're right. I've been an arse.
Yeah, well, we've all got our own personal demons.
God help us. May they be small ones. Night, Sue.
You, come out where I can see you.
Detective.
Jamal. What are you doing here?
I don't know.
So go home. I mean it. This isn't a good thing to be doing.
I need to talk to you.
I said I'm sorry, and I meant it.
You think that makes it all right?
Trust me, Jamal, I don't do apologies. But I know I call this one wrong.
Why?
Because there's a voice in Dale D'Souza's head. It could have been anything, anyone. It's not a real voice. It's chemicals, synapses, an electrical fault. On another day, who knows, Dale D'Souza would have killed himself. It's as near random as these things get. So, there is no why.
No, you bastard! Why? Why did you decide it had to be because of me? But you didn't have to do that.
It's my job to ask questions.
Grabbing the nearest person and pointing your finger right in their face. Easy money.
I had to start somewhere.
He was my brother. My brother. My brother died and it wasn't anything to do with me. Don't you get it?
Okay, Jamal, listen to me. You're right. I had a choice and I called it wrong. I could have stepped back and held my hands up and said, hey, I don't know, but I didn't.
Because you think you're God.
Because it scares me.
Don't talk bollocks.
What happened to Amir wasn't about good or bad or right and wrong. It was just a bloody awful thing. Pointless. But that's not what I do. I'm looking for a reason, a story, someone to blame. Otherwise, what are we talking? Stuff I can't do anything about. Chasing shadows.
You tore my life to bits so you'd feel better about your job.
That's the thing about shadows. They're dark and they're empty. There's nothing there, but you fill them with all the dirty, bad stuff in your own head. That's why they're scary. That's why I called it wrong. That's why you got hurt.
How does any of that help me?
What do you want me to do?
Give me my brother back.
Go home, Jamal. Go home.
In Stone, Demons, Stone was played by Hugo Speer, Mike Tanner by Craig Cheatham, and Sue Kelly by Deborah McAndrew. Jamal and Amir were played by Darren Coupon, Syed by Shiv Gruhl, Mumtaz by Harvey Verdi, and Dale and Jason by Matthew McNulty. McCaffrey and PC Devereaux were played by Jonathan Keeble. Demons was written by Martin Jameson and directed in Salford by Nadia Molinari.
At one period of his life, my friend Father Brown found it difficult to hang his hat on a hat peg without repressing a slight shudder. The cause of this curious idiosyncrasy was indeed a mere detail in much more complicated events, but it was, I believe, the only detail that remained to him in his busy life to remind him of the whole strange business. Its remote origin was to be found in the facts which led Dr. Boyne, the medical officer attached to the county police force, to send for Father Brown on a particular frosty morning in December.
Come in. Ah, Father Brown.
Hello, Dr. Boyle.
Come in, my dear man. Sit you down.
Ah, thank you.
Nice of you to drop in.
Well, you wanted to see me, I understand.
I'm not so sure that I do, you know. I'm not sure about anything yet. I'm hanged if I can make out whether it's a case for a doctor, or a policeman, or a priest.
Well, as I suppose you are both a policeman and a doctor, I seem to be in rather a minority.
An instructed minority, let us say. I mean, I know you've had to do a little in our line as well as your own.
It's true, I have stepped rather outside my priestly duties on occasion.
And very successfully, if I may be allowed to say so. But it's precious hard to know whether this particular business is in your line or ours. or merely in the line that the commissioner's in lunacy.
You intrigue me, Doctor. Pray continue.
Come over to this window for a moment.
Oh, certainly.
You see that large white house on the hill?
Oh, one could hardly avoid doing so. An imposing-looking place, even at this distance.
But somewhat gone to seed in recent years, I'm told. Well, the point is, we've just had a message from the man who lives in it. He's asking us for protection.
Protection?
Against what he describes as a murderous persecution.
Fear of persecution is a not uncommon delusion with certain individuals. I've even encountered it amongst my own flock. But murderous, you say?
His words, not mine. However, if you'll bear with me, I'd better tell you the story from the beginning. We've gone into the facts as far as we could.
Of course.
Well, it seems that a man named Aylmer, who was a wealthy landowner in these parts, married rather late in life and had three sons. But in his bachelor days, when he thought he would have no heir, he adopted a boy whom he thought very brilliant and promising, who went by the name of John Strake.
Some distant relative, no doubt.
No, his origins seem to be vague. Some say he was a foundling, and others insist that he was a gypsy. I think this last notion's mixed up with the fact that Aylmer in his old age dabbled in all sorts of dingy occultism. And the three sons insisted that Strake encouraged him in it.
And a great many other things beside that, I'll be bound.
Quite so. They say Strake was an amazing scoundrel, an astounding liar. But that might be a natural prejudice in the light of what happened. When the old man died, it was found that he'd left practically everything to the adopted son. The three real sons disputed the will, and they said that the father had been frightened into making such a deposition, and, not to put too fine a point on it, driven into a state of gibbering idiocy.
Ah, dear me, these family quarrels are always most distressing.
Anyhow, they seem to have proved something about the dead man's mental condition, for the court set aside the will and the sons inherited.
A meet and proper decision, no doubt. Not to the liking of the adopted son, I imagine.
No, indeed. From all accounts, he reacted violently, as his Strake broke out in the most dreadful fashion and swore he would kill all three of them, one after the other, and that nothing could hide them from his vengeance. It is the third or last of the brothers, Arnold Aylmer, who's asking for police protection.
Third and last?
Yes. The other two are dead.
Oh.
That is where the doubt comes in. There's no proof that they were murdered, but they might possibly have been. The eldest who took up his position as squire was supposed to have committed suicide in his garden. The second, who went into trade as a manufacturer, was knocked on the head by machinery in his factory. Well, we might very well have taken a false step and fallen, but if Strake did kill them, he's certainly very cunning in his manner of getting to work and getting away again.
Well, on the other hand, I suppose it could be that the whole thing is a mania of conspiracy founded on coincidence.
That is where you come into it, Father Brown. I want someone of sense, who isn't an official, to go up and have a talk with this Mr. Arnold Aylmer and form an impression of him. You know what a man with a delusion is like, and how a man looks when he's telling the truth. I want you to be the advance guard before we take the matter up.
Well, it seems rather odd that you haven't had to take it up before. Is there any particular reason why he should send for you now?
He does give a reason. He declares that all his servants have suddenly gone on strike and left him, so that he's obliged to call in the police to look after his house.
Would you suppose there's any truth in his claim? I mean, the whole thing sounds like the whim of some half-witted crank.
The inquiries have made confirm that there has been a general exodus of servants from that house on the hill. Apparently, the servants' account of the matter is that their employer had become quite impossible in his fidgets and fears. That he wanted them to guard his house like sentries or sit up like night nurses in hospital. So, with one voice, they announced that he was a lunatic and left. course, that doesn't prove he is a lunatic, but it does seem rather rum in these days for a man to expect his valet or his parlourmaid to act as an armed guard.
So he wants a policeman to act as his parlourmaid because his parlourmaid won't act as a policeman?
I thought that rather thick, too, but I can't take the responsibility of a flat refusal till I've tried a compromise. You are the compromise.
Oh, very well. I'll go and call on him now, if you like.
Ah, good man. I felt sure I could count on you.
Ooh. I could have done with a thicker overcoat. It's getting cold at every step. And it's about to snow again by the look of those great livid clouds. Ooh. Ooh. Slippery, too. Dear me, the snow has started to fall already. I'd better put up my brolly. Ah, at last. These must be the entrance gates. With luck, I should reach the house before this first flurry becomes a blizzard. An ornate enough piece of ironwork in all conscience. More suitable, I'd say, as the approach to some Italian villa than to an English country house. I suppose the gates have not been locked. So far, so good. A drop of oil might not come amiss. Well, the point was right. The place does appear to have been somewhat neglected. Those shrubs and evergreens have been allowed to run riot, and no mistake. It's too northern to be called luxuriant. Oh, dear. More like an Arctic jungle.
So it was, in some sense, with the house that now came into Father Brown's view. It stood as if waist high in a stunted forest of shrubs and bushes. Its classical facade and row of columns might have looked out on the Mediterranean, but now seemed to be withering in the wind of the North Sea. Carved masks of comedy and tragedy looked down upon the grey confusion of the garden paths, now rapidly disappearing under a layer of snow. But the faces seemed to be frostbitten. The very volutes of the capitals might have curled up with the cold. Father Brown mounted the steps to a square porch flanked by pillars and knocked at the door. About 4 minutes afterwards, he knocked again.
I hope I'm not to be kept standing out here all day. After all, I'm not an Eskimo. No one in front of the house, apparently. Oh, perhaps there's a side door somewhere. I'll try there. Bless my soul, how thickly the snow's lying already. Here we are. Is it locked, I wonder? Bolted or fastened in some way? Perhaps the eccentric Mr. Aylmer has barricaded himself too deep in the house to hear any kind of summons. Or perhaps he assumes that any summons must signal the arrival of the avenging John Stake. Oh, dear. Oh, well. It's unlikely the departing servants will have seen too carefully to the defences. They may easily have overlooked a window, if nothing else. Well, it's worth trying, at any rate. Oh, not such a large place after all, but perhaps a trifle pretentious. Ah, what have we here behind this creeper? A French window and left ajar. Oh, dear, I dislike entering another man's house in this fashion, but needs must when the devil leads.
The room or hall in which our friend found himself was comfortable enough in an old-fashioned way, with a staircase leading up from it on one side and a door leading out from it on the other. Facing him was another door with red-stained glass let into it. On a table to the right stood a sort of aquarium, in which fishes and similar things moved about in the greenish water. Opposite it, in an ornamental pot, a large plant of the palm variety. By contrast, a telephone in a curtained alcove came as something of a surprise to Father Brown.
Well, I'm blessed to find so modern an instrument in such dusty and Victorian surroundings. That's incongruous, to say the least.
Who is that?
Oh, could I see Mr. Aylmer?
I have Mr. Aylmer. You must excuse my dressing gown. I have got out of the way of expecting visitors.
I'm wondering whether it is quite true that you never expect visitors.
You're right. I always expect one visitor, and he may be the last.
I sincerely hope not, but at least I'm relieved to infer that I do not look like him.
You certainly do not. From your habit, I assume you are a man of God.
Yes, my name is Father Brown. Some friends of mine have told me about your trouble and asked me to see if I could do anything to help you. The truth is, I have some little experience in affairs like these.
There are no affairs like this.
You mean that the tragedies in your unfortunate family were not normal deaths?
I mean they weren't even normal murders. The man who is hounding us all to death is a devil incarnate and his power is from hell.
All evil has one origin. But how do you know they were not normal murders?
Why are we talking in the hall? Come in and sit down. Be seated, if you please, and I will endeavour to explain.
Oh, thank you.
I have come to these conclusions by reason. Because, unfortunately, reason really leads there. I have read a great many books on this subject, but what I tell you does not rest on what I have read, but what I have seen. Do I make myself clear?
Perfectly.
In my elder brother's case, I was not certain at first. There were no marks or footprints where he was found shot on the lawn here, the pistol beside him. But that morning he had received a threatening letter. Certainly from our enemy, for it was marked with a sign like a winged dagger.
A dagger with wings?
Just another of his infernal cabalistic tricks.
But is it not possible that your brother may have taken his own life?
That was the verdict at the time. Although a servant in the house swore she had seen a figure moving along the garden wall shortly after she had heard a shot. She said whatever it was too large to be a cat or a prowling dog.
Well, she could have been mistaken.
That is possible, of course. All I can say is that if the murderer came, he left no traces.
But your other brother?
Stephen. Oh, when he died, it was different. Before that, I had only surmised. Since then, I have known. On the day of his death, a machine was working in an open scaffolding under the factory tower. I scaled the platform a moment or two after he had fallen under the iron hammer that struck him. I did not see anything else strike him. But I saw what I saw. You must take my word for what I'm going to tell you now. A great drift of factory smoke was rolling between me and the tower above. But through a rift I saw, standing at the very top of it, a dark human figure, muffled in what looked like a black cloak. Then the smoke came between us. When it cleared, I looked up again at the distant chimney. There was nobody there. I'm a rational man, Father Brown, but how, I ask you, had he reached that dizzy, inapproachable turret? And how did he leave it? My brother's head was smashed beyond recognition, but his body was not much damaged. In his pocket we found one of those warning messages dated the previous day and stamped with the same flying dagger.
This symbol of the flying dagger, might not its use be merely arbitrary, accidental even?
Nothing about that abominable man is accidental. He is all designed, though it is indeed a dark and intricate design, woven out of all sorts of secret languages and signs and nameless evils. I do not pretend to know all that is conveyed by this symbol, but it seems, surely, it must have some relation to all that has befallen my unfortunate family.
The coincidence is certainly very great.
Is that all? Is there no connection, then, between the idea of a winged weapon and the mystery by which my brother Philip was struck dead on his own lawn, without the slightest trace of any footprint or disturbance of the grass? Is there no connection between the dagger and that figure which hung on the far top of that chimney tower, clad in a cloak for wings?
Do you mean that he is in a perpetual state of levitation?
It was a common prediction of the Dark Ages that the Antichrist would be able to fly. Anyhow, there was the flying dagger on the warnings. And whether or not it could fly, it could certainly strike.
What sort of paper were these messages written on?
Oh, you can see what they're like for yourself. For I got one this very morning. I have it in my pocket now. Yes, here it is.
Torn from an artist's sketchbook, I would say. There's no mistaking the symbol. It clearly represents a dagger adorned with wings. Death comes the day after this, as it came to your brother. Mr. Aylmer, you must not let this sort of stuff stupefy you. These devils always try to make us helpless by making us hopeless.
You're right. And the devil shall find that I'm not so hopeless after all, nor so helpless. Perhaps I have more hope and better help than you fancy.
I don't follow you, I'm afraid.
My unfortunate brothers failed because they used the wrong weapons. Philip carried a revolver, and that was how his death came to be called suicide.
The weapon was found beside his body, you said.
That is so, with one chamber empty. I believe my brother tried to defend himself, not to take his own life.
And the other brother?
Stephen had police protection, but he had too great a sense of the ridiculous to allow a policeman to follow him up a ladder to a scaffolding where he stood only for a moment. My brothers were both scoffers, skeptics, if you like, and for that they paid with their lives.
Skeptics? Skeptical of what, may I ask?
Of the strange mysticism of my father's last days. I always knew there was more in the old man than they understood. By studying magic, he fell at last under the blight of black magic, the black magic of this scoundrel Strake. And that is where my brothers were wrong. The antidote to black magic is not brute force or worldly wisdom. The antidote to black magic is white magic.
Well, that rather depends on what you mean by white magic.
I mean silver magic. Do you know what I mean by silver magic?
I must confess that I don't.
Come then. I will show you. This way, please.
The door with the red glass opened into a long, narrow corridor, ending in another door into the garden. Through its glazed panels, Father Brown could see that the lawns and the sweeping fall of the country beyond were covered with the shining pallor of snow.
Here is white magic, anyhow.
What do you mean?
Well, look for yourself.
Oh, yes, the snow. It's going to lie without a doubt. But pray, follow me.
As they made their way along the passage, Father Brown noticed that on one side was an ordinary hat stand with the ordinary dingy cluster of old hats and overcoats, and beside it a single door leading, no doubt, from the proprietor's bedroom. On the other side of the passage was something more interesting, a dark oak sideboard laid out with some old silver and overhung by a trophy of old weapons, pistols and other firearms. Here Arnold Aylmer halted.
Do you see this long, antiquated sort of pistol with the wide mouth?
Yeah.
Do you know why I chose this old blunderbuss?
I can't say I do.
Because I can load it with this kind of bullet.
A silver teaspoon?
Yes, a silver apostle spoon. I merely have to break off the small figure at the top, so... And I have my silver bullet. Now, let us go back into the other room. Sit down, won't you?
Oh, thank you.
Tell me, did you ever read about the death of Dundee?
Dundee? Oh, you mean the man who persecuted the Scottish Covenanters?
None other. Did you know that he could only be shot with a silver bullet because he had sold himself to the devil?
Oh, so it was said.
That's one comfort about you, Father Brown. At least you know enough to believe in the devil.
Oh, yes, I believe in the devil. What I don't believe in is the Dundee. Have you ever heard of Dalrymple of Stair?
No.
At any rate, you've heard of what he did. He was the man who made the massacre of Glencoe.
But I always thought it was the Campbells.
Maybe. Yet it was Dalrymple who instigated the slaughter. He was a very learned man and a lucid lawyer. Quiet man with a very refined intellectual face. Now that's the sort of man who sells himself to the devil.
By God, you're right. A refined intellectual face. That is the face of John Strake. If you will wait here a little while, I will show you something.
Dear me, a madman without a doubt. A and one impelled by a single crazy obsession. I suppose he's gone back to that old sideboard, or possibly to his bedroom. But why? What can be in his mind?
Father Brown gazed abstractedly at the carpet, where a faint red glimmer shone from the glass in the doorway. Once it seemed to brighten like a ruby, and then it darkened again as if the sun of that stormy day had passed from cloud to cloud. Nothing moved, except the aquatic creatures which floated to and fro in the dim green bowl. Father Brown was thinking hard. A minute or two later, he got up and slipped quietly to the alcove of the telephone.
Dr. Boyne, it's me, Father Brown.
Yes, what's the trouble, old chap?
I wanted to tell you about Aylmer and his affairs.
Oh, good, so you've managed to see it?
Yes, I'm in his house at the moment.
Did you get anything out of it?
Yes, I did. It's a queer story, but I rather think there's something in it. I haven't time to go into details now, but if I were you, I'd send some men up here straight away. 4 or 5, I think, and surround the house.
Surround the house? Why? What are you expecting to happen?
Well, I can't tell, but if anything does happen, there'll probably be something startling in the way of an escape. My advice to your people is to send your men up here at once. We've no time to lose.
Very well, I'll take your word for it.
Oh, thank you, Doctor. Well, that's all for the present. Goodbye. No sign of Aylmer. Oh, just as well, since his absence gave me time to make my call. Ah, well, nothing for it but to wait in patience. Curious how the light filters through that glass door, shedding its blood-red pattern on the carpet. Blood, eh? That's an ill omen in the circumstances, I might say. Ah, now it's disappeared again. Strange how it comes and goes. Angels defend us, what kind of...
Glory be to the white magic! Glory be to the silver bullet! That hellhound has hunted once too often, and my brothers are avenged at last.
Merciful heaven, what mischief have you done, Aylmer? No one here. Ah, the bedroom lamps. Locked. Locked, that's odd. The keyhole. No. Nothing to be seen except a bare room. Outside, then. It must be there, if anywhere. Dear God. What have we here?
In the field of snow, which had been so blank a little before, lay a black object. At first glance, it looked like an enormous bat. But approaching nearer, Father Brown saw that it was the body of a man, fallen on its face, the head covered by a broad black hat. The appearance of bat's wings came from the loose sleeves of a vast black cloak, spread out to their utmost length on either side. Peering beneath the hat, Father Brown got a glimpse of the face. It was indeed as Aylmer had described, refined, intellectual, even sceptical and austere.
John Strake. The face of John Strake. Well, I'm jiggered. It really does look like some vast vampire that has swooped down like a bird.
How else could he have come?
Aylmer, you startle me.
No doubt. But you haven't answered my question. If he had not flown, how could he have come?
Well, I suppose he could have walked.
Walked? Look at the snow. It's unspotted. Pure as the white magic you yourself called it. There are no footsteps, but a few of yours and mine. There are none approaching the house from anywhere.
You're right. There are none.
I'll tell you something else. That cloak he flies with, it's too long to walk with. He was not a tall man, and it would trail behind him like a royal train. Stretch it out over his body, if you like, and see.
How did it happen?
I looked out of the door and was turning back when there came a kind of rushing of wind all around me, as if I were being buffeted by a wheel revolving in midair. I spun round somehow and fired blindly, and then I saw nothing but what you see here before you. Nor would you have seen it now if I'd not had a silver shot in my gun. But for that, it would have been another body than John Strake's lying there.
Oh, what shall we do? Leave it lying here in the snow? Or would you like it taken into your room? I suppose that is your bedroom in the passage.
No, no. We must leave it there until the police have seen it.
Oh, yes.
Besides, I've had as much of such things as I can stand for the moment. Whatever else happens, I'm going to have a drink. After that, they can hang me if they like. Confound it, there must be brandy somewhere in the house. Where are those blasted servants hidden it?
Why not try that small cupboard in the corner there?
Yes, of course. Why didn't I think of that before? Ah, here we are. A full decanter and glasses as well. Yes, brandy all right. That's better. Care for a drink yourself?
Thank you, no.
Well, it's up to you. Nothing like a drop of spirit to restore a man's confidence. Damnation!
Steady on. You very nearly upset that bowl of fish.
Not myself, you know. Not myself at all. Legs let me down, you see. It's only to be expected after what I've gone through. Sure you won't join me?
Oh, not for me, thanks.
I see you are still doubtful. Though you have seen the thing with your own eyes. Believe me, Father Brown, there was something more behind the quarrel between the spirit of Strake and the spirit of the House of Aylmer. It's your business to believe in things.
Oh, I do believe in some things, of course. And therefore, of course, I don't believe in other things.
You do believe it. You believe everything. We all believe everything, even when we deny everything. The soul goes round upon a wheel of stars and all things return. Perhaps Strake and I have striven in many shapes, beast against beast and bird against bird, and perhaps we shall strive forever. We seek and need each other. Even that eternal hatred is an eternal love.
No.
What is the good of saying no? You have seen part of that eternal drama with your own eyes. You have seen the threat of John Strake to slay Arnold Aylmer by black magic. You have seen Arnold Aylmer slay John Strake by white magic. You see Arnold Aylmer alive and talking to you now. And yet you do not believe it.
No, I do not believe it.
Why not?
Because you are not Arnold Aylmer. I know who you are. Your name is John Strake, and you have murdered the last of the brothers who is lying outside in the snow.
What? What are you saying? By heavens, I'll have your life for this!
Stop! Put that pistol down. You'll not help yourself by adding one more victim to your crime. The place is surrounded and there's no way of escape.
This house surrounded? I'll not believe you! The police!
That's right, sir. Inspector Collins of the Essex Constabulary. And if you take my advice, you'd better let one of my men take charge of that pistol. See to it, will you, Robinson?
Very good shot.
By what right do you...
We'll come to that in due course, Mr. Strake, if that in truth be your name. Meanwhile, perhaps Father Brown here would explain matters rather more fully.
Certainly, Inspector. That man there is none other than John Strake, and I accuse him of the murder of Arnold Aylmer, as well as of his two brothers, and the attempted murder of myself.
Thank you, Father Brown. That's all I needed to know. John Strake, I'm taking you into custody on a charge of willful murder. And it is my duty to warn you that anything you say now will be taken down and may be used in evidence.
You know, what beats me is the mentality of a man like Strake. Not only does he appear to have confessed his crimes with very little prompting by the police, but from what Inspector Collins tells me, he even seemed inclined to boast to them as victories.
Instead of weaving all that wild romance about winged vampires and silver bullets, he might have put an ordinary leaden bullet into me and walked out of the house.
I wonder he didn't. Coffee, Father Brown.
Thank you.
I don't understand it, but then I don't understand anything yet. How on earth did you discover what you did?
Oh, you yourself, Doctor, provided me with very valuable information, especially the one piece of information that really counted.
And what was that?
Your statement that Strake was an inventive and imaginative liar, with great presence of mind in producing his lies. And this afternoon he needed it. His mistake, perhaps his only one, was in choosing a preternatural story. He had a notion that because I'm a clergyman, I would believe anything.
Other folk have little notions of that kind too, you know. But you must really begin at the beginning.
The beginning of it was a dressing gown.
A dressing gown?
Yes. It's quite the best disguise I've ever known.
How so?
Oh, when you meet a man in a house with a dressing gown on, you assume quite automatically that he's in his own house. I assumed it myself. But afterwards, queer little things began to happen.
Such as?
When he took the pistol down in the hall, He clicked it at arm's length, as a man does to make sure a strange weapon isn't loaded.
But surely he would know whether the pistols in his hall were loaded or not.
Precisely. Oh. Then later on, I didn't like the way he had to look for the brandy, or the way he barged into the bowl of fishes. Now, a man who has a fragile thing of that sort in his rooms gets a quite mechanical habit of avoiding it. But the first real point was this. He came out of the passage between the two doors, and in that passage there's only one other door leading to a room. So I assumed it was the bedroom he'd just come from. I tried the handle, but it was locked. I thought, this is odd. And then I looked through the keyhole. It was an utterly bare room. No bed, no anything. Therefore, he'd not come from inside any room, but from outside the house. And when I saw that, I think I saw the whole picture, as I do now, just as it happened.
Go on, don't keep me in suspense.
Poor Arnold Aylmer doubtless slept and perhaps lived upstairs. But this afternoon, he came out of his room in his dressing gown, descended the stairs, and passed through the red glass door. At the end of the passage, black against the winter daylight, he saw a tall, bearded man in a broad-brimmed black hat and a large, flapping black cloak. He did not see much more in this world.
Strake!
Yes, John Strake. Your family's sworn and mortal foe.
What do you seek here?
Your life. That is what I seek, Aylmer. I have come here to kill you.
Can't do that, no. Stay where you are.
To kill you, I say.
No, I've done you no wrong. I've done nothing to kill you. No. And so at last the score is settled. Arnold Aylmer has paid his debt. The last of the foes who robbed me of my inheritance. What's that? Footsteps. There's someone in the house. What do I do now? I can't be caught here with the body at my feet. I must act, and act quickly.
Those footsteps, Doctor, were mine. I had just entered by the French window. The murderer's reaction was a miracle of promptitude. He took off his big black hat and cloak and put on the dead man's dressing gown. Then he did a thing that affects my fancy as even more grisly than the rest. He hung the corpse like a coat on one of the hat pegs. He draped it in the long cloak and covered the head entirely with his own wide hat.
Hung the corpse in a coat peg? Holy Moses, the man must have the strength of the very devil.
He has. But it was the only way of hiding a body in that little passage with the locked door.
You amaze me.
I myself walked past that hat stand once without thinking it was anything but a hat stand. I think that unconsciousness of mine will always give me a shiver.
Ooh. Your story has done that to me already. But what next? Surely he must have realized that you might discover the corpse at any moment. And hung where it was a corpse calling for a certain amount of explanation, was it not?
Quite so. And therefore he adopted the bolder stroke of discovering and explaining it himself.
How do you mean?
He had already assumed the part of Arnold Aylmer. Why should not his dead enemy assume the part of John Strake?
I'm reminded of that old tale of some frightful fancy dress ball to which two mortal enemies went dressed up as each other.
Only in this case the fancy dress ball was to be a dance of death. And one of the dancers would be dead. That is why I can imagine him smiling.
Smiling?
All things are from God, Doctor. Above all, reason and imagination and the great gifts of the mind. We must not forget their origin, even in their perversion. Now, this man had in him a very noble power to be perverted. The power of telling stories. He was a great novelist. Only he twisted his fictive power to practical evil ends.
Yes, go on.
Well, it all began with his deceiving old Aylmer with elaborate falsehoods and inventions. And gradually, the urge grew stronger, and he became more and more vain of his skill in developing them. That is what the young Aylmers meant by saying that he could always cast a spell over their father. It was the sort of spell that the storyteller cast over the tyrant in the Arabian Nights. He could always produce more Arabian Nights if ever his neck was in danger. And today his neck was in danger.
But I'm still not clear where this sidetracking is getting us. Surely the fellow's a cold-blooded and callous murderer, and that's all there is to it.
That may be so, but I'm sure, as I say, that he enjoyed it as fantasy as well as a conspiracy. He set about the task of telling the true story the wrong way round, of treating the dead man as living and the live man as dead. He'd already got into Aylmer's dressing gown. He now proceeded to get into Aylmer's body and soul. He looked at that corpse as if it were his own, and he decked it out not only in his own dark garments, but in a whole dark fairy tale about the black bird that could only fall by the silver bullet. He completed the exchange by flinging the corpse out on the snow as the corpse of Strake. It spread-eagled in that strange fashion that suggested the sweeping descent of a bird of prey. From this, he did his best to work up a creepy conception of Strake to explain the absence of footprints.
What a rogue.
And for one piece of artistic impudence, I hugely admire him. He actually turned one of the contradictions in his case into an argument for it.
Oh, how's that?
He pointed out that the man's cloak being too long for him proved that he never walked the ground like an ordinary mortal. But he looked at me very hard while he said that, and something told me at that moment he was trying a very big bluff.
Had you discovered the truth by then? I wonder when you suspected and when you were sure.
I think I really suspected when I telephoned you. And yet it was nothing more than the red light from the closed door brightening and darkening on the carpet that had set me thinking. I was sitting alone, and as I gazed down at that crimson patch at my feet, it looked like a splash of blood that grew vivid as it cried for vengeance.
Good gracious me.
Yeah. Why, I asked myself, should it change like that? I knew the sun had not come out. It could only be because the second door behind it had been opened and shut. Someone had gone out into the garden, letting daylight shine along the passage. I began to feel that that person had gone out to do something. It was then I decided to call you, but as to when I was certain, that's a different matter. You see, if he had gone out and seen his enemy then, he would at once have raised the alarm. He did not. It was only some moments later that the fracas occurred.
The cry, the pistol shot, and Strake's entrance with the pistol in his hand.
Yes, indeed.
It boils down to this, then. You say that Arnold Aylmer was killed before you appeared on the scene.
Before or immediately after, that is so.
But that his body was not thrown out onto the snow until sometime later.
Yes.
And that the pistol shot you heard later still had nothing to do with his death.
Nothing whatsoever. It was all part and parcel of Strake's crazy notion to hoodwink me. I knew that right at the end, he was trying to hypnotize me. Just as once he did with old Aylmer, no doubt. But it wasn't only the way he said it. It was what he said. It was the religion and the philosophy of it.
Oh, I'm afraid I'm a practical man, and I don't bother much about religion and philosophy.
You'll never be a practical man till you do. There's just one simple little fact that I've learned simply as a practical man. I've scarcely ever met a criminal who, if he philosophized at all, didn't philosophize along those lines of Orientalism, reincarnation, and the wheel of destiny, and so forth. It is the religion of rascals. I knew it was a rascal who was speaking.
I should have thought that a rascal could pretty well profess any religion he chose.
It was his whole game with me to be as idealistic as possible. That sort of man may be dripping with gore, but he will always be able to tell you sincerely that Buddhism is better than Christianity. Nay, he will tell you in all sincerity that Buddhism is more Christian than Christianity. That alone is enough to throw a ghastly ray of light on his notion of Christianity.
Upon my soul, I can't make out whether you're denouncing or defending him.
It isn't defending a man to say he's a genius. Far from it. And it is simply a psychological fact that an artist will always betray himself by some sort of sincerity.
I'll take your word for that.
You'll have to, Doctor, for I must be on my way. Well, thank you for your excellent coffee and for putting me in the way of an extremely interesting experience.
Thank you, Father Brown.
Good night.
Good night.
When Father Brown set his face homeward, the cold had grown more intense, and yet was somehow intoxicating. It was a piercing cold, but it was not a killing cold. It tingled with truth, and it divided truth from error with a blade like ice. My friend hardly understood his own mood as he drank deeper and deeper draughts of that virginal vivacity of the air. Some forgotten muddle and morbidity seemed to be left behind, or wiped out, as the snow had painted out the footprints of the man of blood. And as he shuffled onwards through the snow, our little priest muttered to himself,
"And yet he's right about there being a white magic, if he only knows where to look for it."
That was The Dagger with Wings by G.K. Chesterton, adapted by Archie Campbell, with Leslie French as Father Brown and William Rushton as G.K. Chesterton. Dr. Boyne was played by Hugh Ross, John Strake by Peter Yap, Arnold Aylmer by Sam Dastor, and Inspector Collins by Stephen Thorne. The production was by Christopher Venning.
As Gunvald Larsson left his office at the police station in Kungsholmsgaten, it was 10:30 at night, and he had no great plans to become a hero.
It was cold and windy outside, with gusts of dry and swirling snow.
On his way home, he was to carry out a minor duty which would hardly set him back more than 5 minutes.
Zacharyson?
Yeah?
Bad news, I'm afraid.
What?
You've got 2 more hours to go. Isaacson's off sick.
Oh, you're joking.
You'd be better off standing on the slope, you know.
Have you stood on the slope?
No.
It's bloody freezing.
Well, what can you see from here?
Enough.
Well, that's debatable, isn't it? Any sign of mob?
Nothing whatsoever. You turned the lights off about 3 hours ago. They had a bit of a party in the upstairs flat, but that's over now.
Has anyone left the house?
I haven't seen anyone.
Well, what have you seen?
3 people went into the building. A man and 2 women. I think they went to the party.
Oh, you think?
I haven't got x-ray eyes.
Are you cold?
What do you think?
Don't be so bloody rude. I'm asking you a civilised question.
Sorry.
I have to take responsibility for this dismal business. I don't want it screwed up by a 22-year-old moron.
Actually, I'm 23.
Christ almighty.
Well, I was just saying...
Get yourself to the station at Rosenlundsgarten and get a bit of coffee inside it. In precisely 30 minutes, I want you back here, fresh and alert. So get a move on.
Zacharyson did not need to be told twice.
Gunvald Larsson then began climbing up the slope, muttering under his breath because the thick rubber soles of his Italian winter shoes couldn't get a grip on the icy stones.
Zacharyson had been right, in that the slope did not offer any shelter whatsoever, and Larsson had been right when he said that this was the best observation point.
There were 4 flats in the old building, 2 on the ground floor, 2 on the first floor.
On the left upstairs flat lived an unmarried woman in her 30s with 3 children.
Below her, on the left, lived an old man who was often drunk and, in spite of his venerable age, was a regular visitor to the cells at Maria Police Station.
To the right, on the first floor, lived a man who was also known to the police. His name was Roth, and it was him who'd had the party.
Below this flat lived a man called Malm. This was the man who was under surveillance.
Larsson looked at his watch.
11:09.
8 minutes left.
Larsson yawned and raised his arms to start beating them around himself.
At that precise moment, the house exploded.
What?
Larsson ran, slipping and swearing down the stony slope and across the street.
The ground floor flat on the right had been in flames for several seconds.
He flung open the front door and saw at once that it was too late. The hallway was already burning, as was the wooden staircase up to the next floor.
As far as he knew, there were 11 people inside the building.
He looked swiftly round for a ladder. There was nothing.
A window was thrown open from the right-hand upstairs flat, and he thought he could make out a woman or a girl.
Right, jump to the right. Now jump, now I'll catch you. Just do it.
She was not at all heavy, and he caught her expertly without her even touching the ground.
She was naked and her whole body was shaking, but she appeared uninjured.
Now there was someone else at the window, a man wrapped in a sheet.
Right, jump. Jump as far out as you can, to the right.
This time he was less successful. The man was considerably heavier than the girl. He hit Larson's shoulder with his left arm and then thudded onto the uneven cobblestones. At the last moment, Larson managed to get his left hand under the man's head and save him from cracking his skull open.
As he turned around, a third person, a woman in a black bra, jumped from the now blazing flat up on the right. Her red hair was alight, and she fell much too near the wall.
Larson rushed in among burning planks and dragged her away from immediate danger. Extinguishing the fire in her hair with snow, she was badly burned.
The windows furthest to the left on the second floor were flung open.
The woman had a child in her arms.
Throw the child! Throw her!
The woman flung down the child so unhesitatingly that he was taken by surprise.
He saw the bundle falling straight at him, and at the last moment flung out his arms like a goalkeeper saving a penalty.
The child was very small.
Larson had no experience of children and could not remember ever having held one.
Zachary, so where the hell have you been? Where the hell's the fire engine?
He should be here. I mean, I saw the fire from Rosalind's garden, so I ran. I telephoned.
Well, call him again. Get the fire engines, get an ambulance, get a bloody move on.
Zachrison ran.
And the police!
Zachrison's cap fell off and he stopped to pick it up.
Jesus.
Much more smoke than before was pouring out through the window where the woman was now standing with another child, a small boy in blue pyjamas.
She flung the boy just as swiftly and unexpectedly as before, but this time Larson was more prepared and he caught the boy safely in his arms.
What's your name?
Larson.
Are you a fireman?
I'm a policeman.
Then Larson looked up again and was hit by a tile.
Ow!
It was red hot and blood poured down his face. The woman at the window then jumped.
That did not go too well.
The woman landed on top of him, and Larson fell onto the ground, hitting the back of his head.
Are you all right?
No.
Have you got another child?
Yes.
Where is she?
The attic.
Oh, gosh.
The whole of the right-hand side of the house was now on fire, the attic included.
The old man was still in the left-hand ground floor flat. For some reason, it had not begun to burn yet, but it could only be a matter of minutes before the roof fell in.
Larson saw a large stone a few yards away.
The stone weighed at least 40 to 50 pounds.
He raised it above his head and flung it with all his strength through the window on the ground floor flat.
This shattered the window and the window frame too.
He covered his face with his scarf and hauled himself inside.
Immediately, he saw the old man lying on the floor. He was unconscious.
Larson slung him over his shoulder and climbed out of the window in a cascade of falling sparks. He could hardly see for the blood running down his face.
Blood-stained, soot-streaked, drenched with sweat, he stood among these hysterical, shocked, unconscious, weeping, dying people.
What happened? How did that...
At that moment, the roof fell in.
Larson looked at his watch.
16 minutes.
What?
I said 16 minutes.
16 minutes had gone by since he'd stood frozen up on that hill.
Chief Inspector Hamar, Larson, Colbert and Beck were sitting in Hamar's office in Kungsholmsgarten.
Larson?
Yes.
Are you quite sure that the fire began in Mom's flat?
Yes.
And is it quite certain that only three people were killed in the fire?
Looks like it. Mom, Roth, who lived above Mom, and then Christina Mudig. She was 14 years old, slept in a room in the attic. And one of the women...
The redhead.
She's critically ill and probably won't survive.
Who were the people who got themselves out then?
Yeah, well, first of all, they didn't get themselves out. I was the one who got them out. If I hadn't been standing there when the house exploded, then not a damn one of them would still be alive. And second, I didn't write their names down. I had other things to do at the time. Eh?
Shouldn't you go home to bed?
What, are you trying to get rid of me?
Well, no, you just don't seem...
What? What don't I seem?
Yourself.
I think he seems exactly like himself, only more so.
What's that supposed to mean?
All right, Larson.
All right, Larson. What about all right, Colby?
So, we find ourselves in the strange position of not knowing what happened.
It's not all that strange. I hardly ever know what's happened.
I mean that we don't know whether the fire was arson or not.
Chief Inspector Hammar had already begun to count the days until he retired.
And he now regarded every serious crime of violence as an act of persecution directed solely at himself.
Why should it be arson?
Well, of course it was bloody well arson. The house practically blew up in front of my nose.
At that moment, Ruin appeared at the doorway.
Gunvald?
Yeah?
You're supposed to be in hospital.
Is he?
Well, can't you see? He's not well.
Well, now you mention it.
I'm taking you to the hospital right now.
Larson?
Yeah?
Why were you shadowing Mom?
I haven't the slightest idea.
Do you believe him?
Who?
Larson.
About what?
Do you really think he didn't know why he was shadowing Mom?
Why would he lie about it?
How did he even end up with this thing?
Mom was arrested for something else, nothing to do with murder, car theft. They tried to keep him in custody, but they had to let him go. And since they didn't want him to vanish, they asked Hammar for help, and he asked Larson to organise surveillance.
Why did he ask him?
I think since Stenstrom was killed, Larson's considered the best we have at that kind of thing. Anyhow, it turned out to be a stroke of genius.
Did it?
Well, he saved 7 lives.
That's true.
I mean, how many do you think Run would have got out of that house, or Melander?
Not many.
Maybe none.
Maybe. Bless you. Why have you always got a cold?
I haven't always got a cold.
There's something wrong with you.
Well, you could talk.
The ruins of the fire looked melancholy. All that was left of the house were the foundations, one chimney stack, and a huge heap of charred boards, blackened bricks and fallen tiles.
Half a dozen experts in grey overalls were crawling about, carefully poking in the ashes with sticks and short spades.
Hoses still snaked their way along the ground.
And down on the road there was a fire engine.
In the front seat sat two firemen playing paper, scissors, stone.
Why's the fire engine still here?
Extinguishing the embers. Routine.
The trip to the burnt-out house told them nothing they didn't already know.
At least it's Friday.
What's so good about Friday?
Day off tomorrow.
Leonard Colbert adored his wife, who was called Gunn, and his 6-month-old daughter, who was called Bodil.
Martin Beck did not adore his wife, Inga, and she did not adore him. His 16-year-old daughter, whom he loved, was rarely at home these days, and he didn't have much of a relationship with his son.
Consequently, Fridays were not the same source of joy for Martin Beck as they were for Lennart Colbert.
And consequently, Mondays were not the same source of unhappiness for Martin Beck as they were for Lennart Colbert.
Got some background on Mom. A couple of police reports. Recording of an interview.
Okay, let's hear it.
All right. Last year, so many cars were stolen, it was thought that a large, well-organised gang must have been involved. Mom was probably some kind of cog in a machine.
Large cog or a small cog?
Small, I should imagine. Very small.
Did he get caught?
On the 24th of February, he was stopped at a roadblock. He was driving a Chevrolet Impala 1963 model. It turned out that the registration number was on a list of stolen cars. But according to this list, the registration belonged to a Volkswagen, not a Chevrolet. Mom said he'd borrowed the car from his friend Ulfsson. A few weeks before this happened, police had found quite a bit of evidence against Ulfsson.
What? Evidence of what?
Car theft, organised, large-scale.
Right.
But then they couldn't find him.
Couldn't find Ulfsson.
Yeah, that's right.
And what did Mom have to say about that?
Mom said Ulfsson lent him the car because he didn't need it while he was abroad. He said Ulfsson was in Poland. Probably Mom worked for Ulfsson, but taking Mom's standard of living into consideration, he can't have paid him much.
I'll get it. Lennart Colbert speaking. What?
What's the matter?
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, thanks.
Who was that?
The pathologist.
What did he say?
Mom wasn't killed in the fire. He was dead before the fire even started. Suicide.
Really?
Apparently he gassed himself.
On the afternoon of Wednesday, the 13th of March, Gunvald Larsson was for the first time given permission to get out of bed at South Hospital.
He looked in the mirror and was not happy with what he saw.
The hospital had given him a dressing gown that was several sizes too small, and its colour had faded into obscurity.
On his feet he wore a pair of black wooden-soled shoes, which had either been made for Goliath or had been intended as a sign to hang outside a clockmaker's.
Inspector Roon speaking.
It's me.
Who's that?
Gunvald, who do you think?
Gunvald, how are you?
How did I end up here?
Where?
In the hospital.
You had concussion.
Really?
You were a bit balmy, actually.
Last thing I remember is wanting to hit Leonard Kohlberg.
That was 5 days ago.
5 days?
How are your hands?
But they seem okay. I don't know, they're covered in bandages.
Well, that's good.
But do you have to begin every sentence with the word well? What's so funny?
Nothing. What do you want?
Right, the back, on the left of the middle drawer of my desk, there's a spare set of keys. Can you go to my house and fetch my dressing gown and slippers?
Well, I think I could manage that.
They give me a pair of shoes that look like coffins. Right, how's the case gone?
Which case?
The fire.
Oh, that's closed.
What do you mean it's closed?
It turns out it was an accident.
An accident?
More or less.
Has everyone gone mad? Has everyone gone bloody mad?
Mr. Larsson, can you keep your voice down, please?
No.
This is a hospital.
Oh, really? I thought it was a golf course.
Mr. Larsson, replace the receiver immediately.
I'll come as soon as I can. I'll bring the report so you can see for yourself.
Did you hear me?
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Back to bed. Now.
Larsson stamped angrily back to his bed in his clodhopper shoes.
Gunvald Larsson was now wearing his own clothes.
And trying to avoid looking at the flowers that Roon had brought with him.
An abominable concoction of carnations and tulips.
But even if the flat was as full of gas as a Mayday balloon, then something or someone must have damn well ignited it.
Well?
Well, what?
Well, almost anything can cause an explosion in a gas-filled room.
Almost anything?
The slightest spark.
Yeah, but the spark has got to come from somewhere.
There's hundreds of explanations.
No. No, there's only one explanation, and no one has bothered to find out what it is.
Roon glanced with modest pride at his flower arrangement.
A short circuit in a switch or a badly insulated cable, that's enough to make a spark. During the fire, the whole electrical system, every fuse blew. No one can prove that one fuse went earlier than the others.
Tell me this, why would Gorham Malm kill himself?
He had no money, he was an alcoholic. He's twice divorced, didn't see his kids. He knew the police were after him. Why didn't he kill himself before now?
Still doesn't explain where the spark came from. Who questioned the survivors?
No one.
No one?
They had nothing to do with Marm.
Well, where are they all now?
They're still in hospital, except the kids. They were taken in by social services. And Madeline Olsen probably won't live.
So the others could be questioned?
Not if the case is closed. Yeah,
do you yourself believe it was an accident?
I do. I really do. I'm sorry, Gunvald.
Where are you going?
I've got to get Matt's birthday present. It's tomorrow. Ondra will kill me if I miss the shops. Mm.
What are you going to get him?
A fire engine.
What?
A fire engine.
Oh, you mean a toy?
Well, what did you think I meant?
I don't know.
Well, take care of yourself.
Yeah.
I'll see you in a few days.
Hey there.
Yeah?
You picked those flowers off somebody's grave.
Roon was clearly offended.
Well, I think they're nice.
The next day was Thursday, the 14th of March, and there was no visible sign that spring was round the corner.
At the South Police Station, Colbert was sitting gulping coffee out of a paper cup and stuffing himself with marzipan cupcakes, scattering crumbs all over Martin Beck's desk.
Martin Beck himself was drinking tea in the vain hope that it would be better for his stomach.
I don't really like this fire.
What?
Something I don't like about it.
What are you talking about? Everything's clear. Marm turns on the gas and kills himself. He doesn't care what happens next. Everything clicks, and don't go saying that it clicks too well.
Beck waited until Colbert was out of the way, then dialed the forensics lab and asked to speak to a man called Yelm.
What do you want?
You saw Marm's body before and after the autopsy, didn't you?
Yes, obviously.
Was there anything at all you would consider unusual?
Not exactly.
Not exactly?
Well, the only thing, if anything, is that the body was so well burned. From all sides. Even on his back. Even though he was lying on his back. But of course, the mattress was burning too, so that's not necessarily an issue. Isn't this case closed?
Yes, yes, it is.
Then why are you calling me?
Thanks. Thank you. You've been very helpful.
Who's being helpful?
No one.
No one?
Dry cleaners, staying up and late for me.
Really?
Hmm.
The blow that produced a veritable constellation of stars was delivered before lunch on the following day.
Wednesday, the 20th of March.
Colbert was sitting at his desk in the South Police Station out in Westberger, trying to solve a chess problem.
It wasn't going too well, because instead he kept thinking of what he was going to have for lunch.
Colbert speaking.
Hello. Yeah, I'm here.
What can I do for you?
Me? What can you do for me?
Well, you called me.
Sometimes I begin to doubt your sanity.
Sorry?
10 days ago, Melanda sent me several hundred objects from the fire, including a large stone with Larson's fingerprints all over it.
All right.
You can say, all right, like that, because you're not the ones who have to sit here and go through it all. It's a hell of a lot easier to put bits of frozen dog shit into a plastic bag and write unknown object on the label than it is to try and find out what it is. Wouldn't you agree?
I know you've got a lot on.
A lot on?
Yes.
Do you know how many analyses we do every year? 50,000. And do you know how many staff we have? So we worked on that stuff for 6 days, and then Einar Roon called up and said case closed. Apparently, we could chuck the whole lot in the bin.
Well, that's right. The case is closed.
No, because before we even started to clear up, Gunvald Larsson called me and said the case isn't closed at all and that we must carry on.
He had no authority to do that. Did you know he had a serious bang on the head?
On Monday, I met Hammer, quite by chance, and he said exactly what Roon said. The case is closed. Then, 15 minutes later, Martin Beck, of all people, phones me up and wonders whether we can find anything unusual about the fire.
When did he do that?
Monday afternoon. So now, today, I try and call someone who might be responsible for all this. And I get Larson's off sick, Hammer's on leave, Beck's in a meeting, and Melinda's in the laboratory. So now, I'm speaking to you.
Unfortunately.
This man, Mom, was lying on his back on a mattress, and he was remarkably burnt on his back. Both Beck and I concluded that this was because the mattress had burnt too. That sounds logical, doesn't it?
Yeah, of course, but you know this case really is closed.
I rather doubt that.
Why?
We found a few things in the mattress which shouldn't have been there.
What things?
A small spring.
Mattresses have springs.
Not a mattress spring, you idiot. A tiny spring to connect a chemical compound with a detonator.
A detonator?
We also found an aluminium capsule and the remains of certain chemicals. The fire was deliberate.
Are you sure?
Someone placed a detonator with a delayed fuse in the mattress.
I have never heard of anything like it.
Well, there have been several devices like it used in France. The ones I've seen could be set for up to 8 hours in advance.
But surely you can hear it ticking.
Well, no more than a wristwatch. And if it was buried in
the mattress... Are you trying to tell me that Mom went home and turned on the gas and then lay down on a bed in which someone else had already placed a time bomb? That he took his own life and was dead when he was murdered?
I'm just telling you the facts as I see them. Explanations I leave completely to you. That's what the police are for. Apparently...
Chief Inspector Hammer, Colbert and Beck were gathered at the police station in Kungsholmsgarten.
Hammer looked grimmer than ever.
He had been secure in the belief that the fire did not concern him, and he had almost forgotten it.
Now the detestable Yelm had ruined all that.
All right. So, Mom was being watched because they hoped he would lead them to Olofsson.
Mm-hmm. And they hoped Mom would testify against Olofsson in exchange for a lighter sentence.
So it's safe to say that Marm had incriminating evidence against Olofsson.
Well, he certainly knew what Olofsson was up to.
So Olofsson could have planted the bomb in order to silence Marm.
It's a possibility.
The only possibility you've got right now.
Yes.
What do we know about Olofsson so far?
Well, on the 12th of February, police discovered that Olofsson had several stolen cars at his summer cottage. There was no one at home, but they found paint, sprayers, number plates and registration certificates in the garage.
Two men were sent to Olofsson's flat in Stockholm, but he wasn't there. And he's still missing.
When was this?
February 12th.
A Monday.
When Malm was caught, he said that Olofsson had gone abroad.
So they kept the flat in Stockholm and the cottage under observation.
Does anyone know when he was last in his flat?
Don't think so.
Get going then, gentlemen. Ask the neighbours and everyone you can get hold of. Everyone who had anything to do with Olofsson.
Rune was dispatched to talk to Olofsson's mother. Beck and Colbert went first to the flat in Stockholm and then on to the summer cottage.
A week passed and there was no news.
On Monday, the 25th of March, Larsson returned to work.
Right, what the hell's going on?
Read this.
What is it?
The latest report on the investigation into the fire.
What does it say?
That Malm was a car thief and he was in a gang with someone called Olofsson. Malm was a small cog in a big machine. Olofsson was a slightly bigger cog, although still pretty small, as cogs go. But bigger than Mom.
What the hell are you talking about?
Read the report. The report explains it better.
Well, you told me the case was closed.
Well, it was till Hjalm found out someone put a time bomb in Mom's mattress.
Are you making this up?
We think it was Olofsson who planted the bomb.
What, in the mattress?
Yeah.
A time bomb?
Hjalm says they have them in Algeria.
Well, where's Olofsson now, then?
He's missing. Maybe abroad. Interpol can't find him. Well, hello, Rune speaking. Sorry, hang on a minute. It's just me wife. Hang on a minute, Under. Just read the report. It's all in the report. Sorry, Under, go on. What? Is Mats all right? Well, why is he crying? He's disappeared. Well, are you sure? All right. Well, keep on looking, and I'll speak to you later. Yeah. All right, bye-bye. Oh, I can't believe it.
What's happened?
His fire engine. You know, Matt's fire engine, the one I got for his birthday, it's disappeared. I mean, it's this big. We live in a tiny flat. I mean, where could it go?
The fire engine?
Yeah.
The fire engine that disappeared?
What?
Has anyone spoken to Zacharyson?
Zacharyson?
That idiot in Maria.
Yeah, he doesn't know anything useful.
Yeah, you're telling me.
Well, where are you going?
Find Zacharyson.
But he doesn't know anything.
I want to ask him about the fire engine.
What fire engine?
The fire engine that disappeared.
Six hours later, Larsson was wondering how anyone was supposed to find a murderer in this city when he couldn't even find a policeman.
Eventually, he traced him to the Eriksdal Baths.
Get out.
What?
Get out of the water.
What are you doing here?
I just want to know one thing.
Can I get dressed?
What?
It's cold standing here.
Jesus, every time I see you, you're complaining it's cold.
Well, if I could just get dressed.
When you got to the fire in Hurlgarten, you whittled on about how the fire service ought to have been there already. What did you mean by that?
Well, it wasn't. It wasn't me that called the fire service. Not the first time, it was someone else.
Who?
I've no idea. I saw the fire when I got to Rosengarten, so I ran back to the nearest telephone box and central alarm said they'd already been called and that a fire engine was already there.
And was it?
No. That was a strange thing. And then you told me to... So then I ran back again.
And what did central alarm say then?
Well, I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't remember.
How can you be so unimaginably stupid that you've not told anyone about this?
But what should I have told them?
The fire service had already been alerted when you called them and the fire engine had disappeared.
I don't understand.
Christ almighty. Do you remember what you told Central Alarm the second time you called them? Do you remember what you told them?
There's a fire. There's a fire in Hurlgarten.
And they didn't say that the fire engine was already there?
No. No, they didn't.
But the first time you called, did you shout the same thing? There's a fire in Hurlgarten?
No. The first time I left the address, I told them 37 Ringvägen.
But the house was in Hurlgarten?
Yeah, but the correct address is 37 Ringvägen.
So you said 37 Ringvägen the first time, but Hurlgarten the second time?
Well, everybody knows that 37 Ringvägen's in Hurlgarten.
I didn't know that. Someone called Central Alarm at exactly 23:10, at exactly the same time as the bomb exploded.
How do you know that?
Because I've spoken to that idiot Zacharyson, and I've spoken to the fire service.
Go on.
Right, and the only person who with any certainty could have known that the fire was to break out at 23:10 is the person who planned the fire.
Olofsson.
Well, Olofsson or whoever it was.
Why would he ring the fire service?
Probably because he didn't want to kill everyone, just Mom.
A girl answered the phone, some girl called Doris Mortensen. Now, I expect she can tell us something about the voice, but she's on holiday. She'll be back in 3 weeks.
Excellent work, Gunvald. Really excellent work.
Thank you.
The days went by. A new month began. Another week passed, soon almost two, and still no trace of the man called Olofsson.
The girl called Doris Mortensen returned from holiday on the evening of Saturday, the 20th of April.
At 8 o'clock on Monday morning, she was standing in front of a large mirror in her bedroom, admiring her suntan.
She pulled a dress over her head and went to open the door.
There stood a gigantic blonde man in a very expensive suit.
He stared at her with china blue eyes.
Hi.
Hi.
How was Greece?
Wonderful.
And did you know that the military junta tortures people to death there every day?
I didn't.
How is that possible?
I just booked a holiday.
She looked at him appraisingly.
This was a real man. She could see that at once. Nice.
Who are you?
Detective Larson. At 11:10 on the evening of the 7th of March this year, you received a false alarm over the telephone. Do you remember it?
Yes. It was Ringvergen in Sundbyberg.
Good. Now, what did the person say?
There's a house on fire at 37 Ringvergen, ground floor.
Man or woman?
Man.
And you're certain about his actual words?
Pretty certain.
Did you notice anything else?
Well, as soon as I found out it was a false alarm, I tried to remember the conversation. The police usually want to know about it afterwards. The police here, I mean. But this time they didn't inquire.
The man scowled. It suited him. She thrust her right hip forward a little and at the same time bent her knee, so that the heel came up from the floor. She had good legs, and now they were suntanned as well.
So, what else?
He was calling from a public telephone. I heard it clicking in the coin box before the call was put through, and he was probably calling from a phone box in Sundbyberg.
Why do you say that?
Well, because the old kind of notices are still in some of those phone boxes, with a line direct to us. They're trying to get everyone to ring the emergency number now. To Central Alarm in Greater Stockholm.
Oh, that's good. That is very good. Thanks.
I was going to ask him what his name was, but he hung up.
Okay.
Aren't you the man who saved all those people? I recognise your face from the photo.
You've obviously got a very good memory.
I didn't imagine you were so tall. And so...
She wished she hadn't put her slippers on. She had good feet. She knew that.
And what else do you remember about the man?
Well, he wasn't Swedish. He had an accent, quite a strong one.
And what kind of accent?
French, maybe?
Why do you think French?
She frowned and thought back. She must look quite interesting now.
Well, he said hows, or more ows, for house. I hardly heard the H.
Ows instead of house.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. That is really great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You are the greatest.
Really?
Remembering things.
Oh.
Is it even possible that Olofsson speaks Swedish with a strong accent and says ours instead of house?
Larson, Beck, Colbert and Rune were all gathered at the police station in Kungsholmsgården.
Sounds unlikely.
Yeah, it does.
Well, so who was it then?
It's a mystery.
If Olofsson was the person who telephoned, then he might well have disguised his voice.
Well, we know one thing, don't we?
What's that?
Well, whoever it was who made the call made it from a telephone with one of those notices. The ones with the number for Sundbyberg Fire Department.
Rather than Central Alarm?
Yeah. So the question is, how many telephone boxes are there with the old type of notices?
I've no idea.
But we could send someone out with a map to mark all the telephone boxes with the old notices and try and work out where he made the call. And maybe, if someone saw him, we could identify
that
him.
That is a hell of a long shot.
What, have you got any better ideas?
And who's going to go looking? Who's got that time?
And what about that new bloke you've got in Vestberger? Tacker?
Skacker. Benny Skacker.
You could send him, couldn't you?
For Martin Beck, the weekend proved extremely trying. He had annoying anxiety about the case, which was clearly about to become totally entangled, and he received another blow of a more personal nature.
His daughter, Ingrid, informed him that she was moving out.
It was true that for a long time he'd seen this moment coming. What he hadn't foreseen was his own reaction.
His mouth went dry, and he felt quite dizzy.
Dad?
Yes.
I know I shouldn't say this, but I'm going to say it anyway.
What?
Why don't you do the same thing?
What do you mean?
Why don't you move out? You should think about it. At least think about it.
Well, yes, but...
He stopped then.
Quite simply, he didn't know what to say.
On Monday the 29th, two events occurred almost simultaneously.
One of them was not particularly remarkable.
Here's my report.
Your report?
On the telephone boxes.
Oh, OK, thanks.
There's 6 telephone boxes where the old notices remain, also 2 more possible ones.
Well, what do you mean, possible ones?
Notices which were still up on the 7th of March, but have since been taken away.
Oh, good. Thanks.
Skacker stood 6 feet away from him, strongly resembling a dog sitting up begging for a sugar lump.
Martin Beck speaking.
It's Per Monson in Malmö.
Hi.
I hear you're looking for someone called Olofsson.
That's right.
And we found him.
Where?
Sitting in a car at the bottom of the harbour.
Oh.
He was killed with a stone stuffed into a sock. There wasn't a thing in the car except the weapon and 2/3 of Olofsson.
When did you find him?
3 weeks ago, but I didn't know who he was till today.
Are you sure it's him?
Well, the dental record for his upper jaw fits.
And the rest of it? Fingerprints?
We couldn't check on fingerprints. He'd been in the water a long time.
How long?
At least 2 months.
Which means he must have been dead on the 7th of March.
Definitely. Maybe a month before then.
Well, he was last seen in Stockholm on the 3rd of February.
So that helps me fix a date then. He must have been killed somewhere between the 4th and the 8th of February.
I'll come and see you as soon as I can.
Valpurgis Eve is an important day in Sweden. A day when people put on their spring clothes and get drunk and dance and are happy.
Martin Beck and Per Monson spent this happy day in a mortuary in Malmö.
Looking at what was left of Bertil Olofsson.
Is there anything that connects Olofsson with Malmö?
It looks as if Olofsson mainly dealt in stolen cars. And drugs, apparently, but mainly cars. Maybe he drove the cars to Malmö to sell them on. I don't know yet.
Well, our starting point isn't so bad.
Isn't it?
We know Olofsson was in Stockholm on the 3rd of February, and the doctor swears he must have been dead at the latest on the 7th. I can probably find someone who met him.
Really?
Malmö is small, and the circles Olofsson moved in are even smaller.
If we assume there's a connection between the attempted murder of Malm and the murder of Olofsson...
It seems unlikely the two events aren't related.
Can we assume that there's also a connection with Malm's suicide?
Well, he could have done it because he knew the game was up.
Exactly.
So he was scared of being killed, but by whom? Only a pro uses something like a stone in a sock.
Or a time bomb in a mattress.
Which is why the professional called the fire service. It was his job to kill Malm, but he wasn't the slightest bit interested in killing everyone else in the building.
Why are people eliminated by professional killers?
Olofsson and Malm resprayed cars, found them false number plates and then drove them across the border to some country where they either sold them or handed them over to someone else.
So, they were managing the Swedish end of this whole enterprise, and then they made some kind of mistake, and the firm they were working for decided to get rid of them.
Who the hell is going to believe a theory like that?
Nobody.
At this moment, Einar Rune came into the room.
Nobody's going to believe what?
Einar?
Yeah?
We have come to the conclusion that Malm and Olofsson worked for an international crime syndicate. We think the syndicate got tired of them and sent a hired assassin, probably a foreign professional, to finish them off. What do you think?
Sounds like bollocks.
There you go. Yeah.
Gunvald Larsson didn't have much hope of success when he suggested sending Benny Skacker out to try and find any trace of the man who called up the fire station on the 7th of March.
Skacker, however, took on his assignment with great enthusiasm.
His work consisted of visiting tenants in every building within the encircled areas. And even for a young man with well-trained leg muscles, this was tiring work.
His line of inquiry was also impossibly vague. All he could ask people was whether they knew of any foreign man
living in the building at the end of March
who may have made a call to the emergency services.
On the 7th.
Larson and Beck had long since given up asking him how it was going.
On Friday, Skakko went to his beloved Sunby Bear to continue knocking on doors.
The first door was opened by a lady with henna-coloured hair and glasses with green plastic frames.
Benny Skakko had to repeat himself several times to make it clear what he wanted.
Oh, yes, I rent one of my rooms. That is, I used to. The last one I had was a Frenchman. Oh, was he Arab? He sounded French, anyway.
A French-Arab?
That's right. I think so, anyway, but he spoke Swedish. Not very well, but I could understand him all right, so it wasn't any kind of problem.
Can you tell me when he was here?
I can tell you exactly when. He was the last person to take the room, actually. It was the 4th of March he arrived, paid the rent in full in advance. But he left on the 8th, didn't stay the whole week. I said to him, you can't get any money back now because you booked a week. But he didn't seem to mind.
What was his name?
Alphonse LaSalle.
You could have knocked Skakko down with a feather.
As he rushed back to Kungsholmsgatan,
in his mind,
he had already been promoted
and was yet another step closer to becoming chief of police.
In Kungsholmsgatan, Gunvald Larsson said,
what was he wearing?
I didn't ask.
Well, what kind of overcoat did he have? Suit, shoes, socks, shirt, tie? Did he smoke?
I don't know.
Well, why didn't the stupid woman send in a registration card when she had a foreigner living with her?
I didn't ask.
Well, what did you ask?
Just, you know, what I've said already.
They found several fingerprints in the room in Sundbyberg.
When they eliminated all those belonging to Mrs. Borg and Skakko, three were left, one of which was a thumbprint preserved in thick, greasy hair oil.
On Tuesday, they sent out copies of the fingerprints to Interpol.
What else could they do? On the Monday after Ascension Day, Chief Inspector Hamar told Beck to call Månsson up and ask him how things were going.
Hamar was standing 6 feet away from Beck when he made the call.
Beck regretted calling the moment he heard Månsson's voice.
Well, when I've anything to tell you, I'll let you know.
Right. Ask him if there are any further developments, generally speaking.
I just wondered if there are any further developments, generally speaking.
Who is that mumbling in the background?
Chief Inspector Hamar.
It's like that, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Ask him if he's taken the international perspective into consideration.
Chief Inspector Hamar would like to know if you've taken the international perspective into consideration.
Yes, I have.
Yes, he has. He's gone.
Listen, about Olofsson. I've found people who knew him a bit, but nothing we didn't already know before. Apparently he had a big mouth. Apparently he sold drugs. He was always driving a new car, and he turned up here in Malmo about once a month. Stayed for a few days and was gone again. Mom was here too.
Really?
They were seen together a few times.
That's interesting.
Not much help.
No.
And more importantly...
What?
No one knows where he stayed when he was here.
Olofsson or Mom?
Olofsson. Apparently the girl's somewhere. I'll find her in the end. But it'll take a while. And I'm going on holiday in June.
When the telephone rang in Martin Beck's office, it was 3 minutes past eight on a Friday morning.
Friday the 26th of July, 1967.
Par Månsson was calling from Copenhagen to say that he had found the girl.
He also said he was taking the first flight he could get to Stockholm and that he'd be with Beck by one.
Everyone gathered at the police station in Kungsholmsgatan to hear what he had to say.
Everyone, including Hammer, Melander, Larsson, Beck, Kolper, Rune and Skakko.
Månsson arrived just before one, looking suntanned, calm and pleased with himself.
Martin Beck wondered how the hell Månsson, a man 2 or 3 years older than himself, could appear so fit and contented.
It's like this. The woman's name is Nadja Eriksson. She's 37 years old and a sculptor.
Conversation with Nadja Eriksson, born on the 6th of May 1931 in Malmo. Shall we summarise all this about Bertil Olofsson?
I met him almost 2 years ago. The first time in September 1966 and the last time at the beginning of February this year. He came here regularly, mostly at the beginning of each month. When he was here in Copenhagen, he stayed with me.
Why was he such a regular visitor?
We had an arrangement. When I met Bertil Olofsson, quite by chance down in Nyhavn, I asked him if he had any of the drug Simpatina. Since they made it illegal, it's too expensive for me to buy on the black market. In exchange for Simpatina, I let him stay at my place. He had a kind of timetable. Usually he came via Malmö.
What did Olofsson do?
Well, in the beginning he told me nothing, but in the end he couldn't stop himself talking. He was the kind of man who just couldn't keep his mouth shut. Oh, God, it's hot in here.
Mornson turned his toothpick over with his tongue.
There's a brief interruption here. Technical fault.
The slightest success went to his head, and he was always talking about his big plans.
To summarise?
He and another man were getting hold of stolen cars in Stockholm. Then they fixed those cars so that no one would recognise them and drove them to the continent. Mostly to Poland, I think. But this business wasn't their idea. They were just underlings.
Quarter's a bit tricky. I bored it off the Danes.
Mornson yawned and changed his toothpick.
When the woman came back on the tape, her voice sounded different, but it was not easy to say in what way.
I went to Malmö once. Mostly because I was curious. Actually, it was very boring. I met someone called Marm, his business partner. So Olofsson started talking about so-called head office making these massive profits and how him and Marm were getting nothing and they did all the work and took all the risk. He said that if they took over the business, they'd all earn a hell of a lot of money. And in December, he did something unbelievably stupid.
And what was that?
He followed the guy who brought him the money. Took a plane to France or somewhere. But I think he really did make the trip because in January he seemed very nervous. He said head office were going to send a negotiator. When he talked, it was always in those sort of terms, as if it were really some ordinary business affair. On the 6th of February, he came here. At about 3 the next day, he went out and he never came back.
So there we go.
Extremely skillful interrogation. How did you get her to talk so freely?
Oh, it wasn't difficult.
Brilliant. Just brilliant.
Can you rely on it?
Absolutely.
It occurred to both Martin Beck and Lennart Colbert that the interview was rather odd, but neither of them could work out why. What they didn't know was that Pär Mårtensson had spent the previous 3 days in bed with Nadja Ericsson, which was why their dialogue had an easy familiarity and a number of interruptions.
Well, that's about it for me. Excuse me a moment.
He stood up and went into the corridor.
Einar Runn got up and followed him. For most of the time, he had been sitting thinking of something besides Olofsson, namely that Mornson was said to be an expert in house searches.
Pär?
Yes?
Would you like to come back and have dinner with me and my wife?
I would, very much indeed. Thank you.
Good.
Mornson liked food very much. Mm-hmm. He had high standards and knew how to appreciate a well-prepared meal.
Crisply fried venison slices with scrambled eggs were followed by a dish of golden brown grouse with cloudberry jelly.
Mornson was a happy man.
Where does such wonderful food come from at this time of year?
We got the venison from my brother. He goes shooting quite a bit.
We've got an old reindeer in the freezer.
Not with the antlers still on.
You can't eat the antlers. You've got to chop them off first.
And what are you going to be when you grow up?
A fireman.
Not a policeman?
God, no. I hope not.
Oh, thanks. I wanted to ask you something, actually.
What's that?
Well, the strangest thing happened. Matt's had this toy fire engine, and it just disappeared. I mean, it's just gone.
Have you looked under the reindeer?
I've looked everywhere. I've turned the house upside down.
Well, we'll find it. If it's here, we'll find it.
They went together through the whole flat, and Mornson couldn't find a place where Runn had not already searched several times.
Can you think of anything that's been moved out of here? Something that might have been sent for repair?
There's been nothing like that.
Has anyone else been here who might have taken it with them?
Well, no, because he wasn't well for that week. We didn't go out and we didn't have anyone to see us.
Has anyone else been here? Someone who came to fetch something or read the meter or another workman?
You think someone stole it?
Well, I was thinking it was more likely that someone took it by mistake.
Well, the caretaker was here. That was a few days after Matt's birthday. He was bleeding the radiators.
I didn't know that.
I forgot to tell you.
Did he have a toolbox with him?
Yes.
Big enough to hold a fire engine?
Definitely. Yes.
And does he live in the building?
Yes. On the ground floor.
I'm sorry to bother you, Mr. Svensson.
What can I do for you?
Is that your toolbox, Mr. Svensson?
Yeah.
How long is it since you last used it?
I don't know, really. It's been a while because I've been in hospital for an operation. I'm all right now, but, well, I haven't been working for the last 3 weeks.
Do you mind if we take a look?
No, of course not.
Well, sorry, Mr. Svensson.
What's all this about?
There, among the hammers, screwdrivers and wrenches, lay the fire engine, red and shining.
The following morning, Lennart Culber appeared at Martin Beck's door waving a piece of paper.
Bingo.
What?
Interpol have identified Alphonse Lassalle, the fingerprint. Only he's not really called Lassalle. No one knows what he's called. He's got loads of names. They're sending a list. He's suspected of drug trafficking, currency smuggling, murder. Long, long list.
Has he ever been caught?
Apparently not.
Perhaps he'll come back.
Optimist.
Why shouldn't he come back? He speaks Swedish. If the firm decides to build up its Stockholm branch again, he'd be extremely valuable. And he has no idea that we know who he is.
But we don't know who he is. We don't even know his real name. And even if he does come back, then what can we prove?
We can't blame the fire on him, but he's pretty well tied to the murder of Olofsson.
That's true, but that's Monson's case, not ours. And anyway, he won't be back.
Well, I'm going to ask Interpol and the French police to keep their eyes open.
You do that, but he won't be back.
Just over a month later, Lennart Culber was sitting in his office in Vestberga, puzzling over the whereabouts of a 17-year-old girl. People were constantly missing, especially girls, and mostly in the summer. Nearly all of them appeared again.
It was raining outside. Fresh, clean summer rain.
Culber liked rain, especially this fresh kind of rain after oppressive heat, and he looked with pleasure at the grey clouds.
He looked at the clock. 5:30. Time to go home.
And then, of course, the telephone rang.
Hello.
Hello, it's Strömgren.
What is it?
Something for Beck?
He's on leave.
Oh.
What is it?
A telex, but I don't really understand it.
Read it to me.
LaSalle inquired about probably en route from Brussels to Stockholm, extra flight SNX3, estimated at our lander, 18:15 hours, name Samir Malgach, passport Moroccan.
Great. That's just great.
Do you know what it's about?
Yes.
So what do I do now?
I'll sort it out. Did you say 6:15?
18:15 hours, yeah.
Okay. Gun, it's me. It looks as if I'll have to go out to our lander.
Well, that's a shame.
Yes, it is.
What time will you be back?
No later than 8.
OK. Hurry home.
I will.
Leonard?
Yeah?
I love you.
She hung up before he had a chance to reply.
Skakka!
Skakka did not immediately respond.
The only thing Culber could hear was the rain, and in some way or other, this was no longer pleasant.
It's a chat, okay?
Okay.
Nothing's gonna happen. I mean, there's a small chance we can unnerve him enough so that he gives himself away, but let's see.
He's very dangerous, isn't he?
He's cunning and ruthless, but probably not all that bright. Of course, most policemen aren't all that bright either, so in that respect, the odds are about even. Why are you fidgeting?
I don't like this holster.
You're wearing a gun?
Of course. Aren't you?
No. I don't believe in it. I think all policemen should be disarmed completely.
But then what do we do when we're faced with a gun?
How often in your life have you been faced with a gun?
Never, but that doesn't
no,
mean...
No, it doesn't, but it's a hell of a lot more likely to happen if you produce a gun yourself.
The plane was a Sabena Caravelle, and it landed 10 minutes late, by which time Culber was already so tired of both Arlanda and his earnest colleague that he had nearly yawned his jaw out of joint.
Colbert was standing just by the door, and Skacker about 5 yards inside the airport lounge.
The passengers filed into the building.
First in was a prominent Russian diplomat.
2 yards behind him came his beautiful wife.
And 4 yards behind her came Alphonse Lassalle.
Or Samir Malga.
Or whatever his name was.
Colbert involuntarily glanced at the Russian diplomat's beautiful wife.
This glance was the most fateful mistake Colbert had ever made in his life.
Because Skacker misinterpreted it.
Colbert turned to Lassalle and raised his hat slightly.
Excusez-moi, Monsieur Malga.
At that exact moment, Colbert saw Skacker take out his gun.
Skacker, for Christ's sake!
The moment Lassalle saw the pistol, he produced a knife which he must have had up his sleeve.
Colbert realized that the man intended to cut his throat. And while he had time to raise his left arm to parry the knife, the other man turned with lightning speed and stabbed him just below the ribs instead.
Like a hot knife through butter.
As the saying goes.
Thought Colbert.
Colbert fell, doubled over, his head down to protect his carotid artery. The knife went up again.
At that moment, Skacker fired.
The bullet hit Lassalle, or whatever his name was, in the center of the chest and threw him violently backwards.
The scene was completely static. Skacker was standing there with his arm outstretched. Lassalle was lying flat on his back. Colbert was lying on his side with his hands pressed against his diaphragm. Everyone else was standing still, and no one had time to scream.
You were right.
No.
Why did you wink at me?
I didn't.
No. Oh, God.
And then panic and chaos broke out.
As usual.
When everything is over.
In the ambulance on the way to Merbee Hospital, Lennart Colbert was at first immensely scared of dying. Then he looked at the man in the other stretcher. The man looked at Colbert with eyes that were rigid with pain and terror.
He tried to move his hand, perhaps to make the sign of the cross, but all he could manage was a slight jerk.
By the time they reached the hospital, Alphonse Lassalle,
or whatever his name
was dead.
Oh, this isn't fair.
But
I wasn't even interested in this case.
Excuse me, Doctor.
Yes?
Leonard Kohlberg. Will he die?
No. No, he won't. But it'll be a month or two before he can thank you.
Thank me?
Didn't you save his life?
No. No, I didn't.
In The Fire Engine That Disappeared, by Mai Huerval and Pavel Lehr, Martin Beck was played by Stephen McIntosh and Lennart Colbert by Neil Pearson. Larson was played by Ralph Ineson. Run by Russell Bolter. Gunn Colbert, Sally Orrock. Nadia, Christine Absalom. Muensen, Stuart Macquarie. Zachrisson, Joe Sims. And Strumgren by Harry Livingston. Hamar was played by Patrick Brennan. Yelm by Robert Blythe. Skacker, Sam Alexander. Mrs. Borg, Susie Riddell. Ingrid Beck, Lauren Crace. Doris, Healy Beresford. And Mats, Greta Dudgeon. The narrators were Leslie Sharp and Nicholas Gleaves. The Fire Engine That Disappeared was translated from the Swedish by Joan Tate and dramatised for radio by Katie Himms.